mentioned it
yeah,
to
Yeah, also
something,
said something about Blood Rock. Yeah, and Andrew messages me. He's like, did you fucking tell them to say that? I'm like, I swear to God. It is not. I'm not going around secretly telling people to say that your music is butt rock in articles.
What did I just miss? Exactly.
You missed some pretty golden shit.
You missed this whole argument?
Okay. All right. Well, I'm tethering off my phone, so I think we're good to go now. Sorry about that clusterfuck of a start. But okay. All right, let's get rolling, guys. So the show is Serpent Riders. I'm here with Matto, and we're pretty lucky today because we've got three of the most awesome dudes, I think, in the gaming industry at the moment. We've got...
Thank you.
Yeah, we got Dave Oshry. We got David Szymanski. Did I pronounce that right?
Yep.
Cool. And we got Andrew Holschult, who is a pretty awesome dude too, and everyone should know who he is. And if you don't, you will by the end of this video. So, guys, just first off, thank you for making Dust, because I think everyone who's played it and who's seen the videos is going to agree it's pretty damn awesome. So,
thank you.
Look, before we get into
legends,
before we get into talking about Dusk, which I do want to do, and I want to kind of pick your brains a bit, maybe we could just go around. And do you guys want to kind of tell us a little bit about your history in gaming? I mean, like what games you guys kind of played growing up and that kind of stuff. Maybe we'll start with Dave, and then we'll go Andrew, maybe, and then David at the end.
Sure. Oh man, so what did I start? What did I grow up playing? Everything. I mean, I was born in the 80s. I'm an old man. And I had this. They had this thing back then that my grandma called Nintendo. But yeah, started Nintendo. But I think what really changed my life was when I went over to my buddy's house and he had a 386, which was pretty fucking powerful at the time. And we were able to play this game. It was a 3D game. We could only play it in black and white, but you were able to run around in 3D and shoot Nazis in the face. And it was the coolest thing I had ever seen in my life. And that game, as you know, was Wolf 3D.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget going over to my friend's house, who had a 386 at the time, which was the most powerful computer in the fucking world, the Pentium 386. We still haven't ever gotten any more powerful. I think that really, and that's the game that, like, changed from when I was, you know, playing, you know, Nintendo and stuff with my dad to holy shit, PC games, mouse and keyboard. And from there, it just, you know, spiraled from Wolf to Doom to Quake to fucking everything. And then I got into PC RPGs, you know, became a big fan of stuff like Fallout, Baldur's Gate, anything Interplay was putting out in the 90s, I had to have. And then, you know, from there, it's been mostly PC ever since. And then, you know, it got pretty crazy because, you know, growing up playing games like Quake, Doom, Rise of the Triad and stuff, me and Andrew, next thing you know, it's like 2012 and we find ourselves working on a reboot of Rise of the Triad with some of the dudes who worked on the original game. And it's still pretty fucking weird at this point that we're like so involved with these IPs that we like played as kids.
Mm.
And it's how it's kind of come full circle. Like, you know, the games we played growing up are games that we work on now. Totally. And the coolest part is, now we're making games that are derivative of those games because it's been so long that shit's starting to come back in style. And it's like coming back in force now. It's been a few years. I think we kind of really peaked. I mean, since most of this conversation is probably going to be about Dusk and retro FPS and stuff, because I think that's kind of why we're all here and why we're talking to you, because that's your wheelhouse too, man. Anybody who watches your channel knows what you're about.
Yeah.
So, you know, and I think Doom 2016 was really the fucking pinnacle of bringing it all back, and I'm glad that it was Doom that finally, like, you know, fully brought back, you know, like, we're gonna go really fucking fast and carry as many weapons as we want and play really fucking loud metal music, you know. And I think I'm glad that we're back there, you know, because when we were doing Rot a few years ago, we were still knee deep in like linear Call of Duty style shooters, and, you know, we were one of the first to start doing retro stuff, and now like retro is so in. So with Dusk, we already know that there's like all these people who are super into these types of games, especially with Doom and stuff coming back, you know, Doom, Shadow Warrior, Wolfenstein, you know, our Rot reboot, stuff like that. So it's fun that it's come full circle, you know, the stuff that we played growing up, or at least I played growing up. I'm pretty sure you guys are about to name like all the same games that I just did growing up. But now we're making a game. Now we're making a game like that. Yeah. Waldo's going to be like, Quake. Okay, next question. But yeah, for me, it was, you know, it was like Nintendo and stuff, but then like, you know, all the id Apogee stuff leading into, you know, where we're at now.
Yeah, cool. And I'm glad you said you like Doom 2016, because Matto's actually known for killing people who don't like it, so that was the best possible outcome.
I purged the scum off the
surf. I don't know anybody who doesn't like Doom.
Oh, we know a few. Yeah, there's a couple out there. We won't name names, but there's one guy that Matto is,
I get triggered the moment I hear his name.
Yeah, like full-on sort of blown triggered by it. So
I don't care what anyone says. Doom 2016 is just a gift from God.
Totally.
Cool. All right, well, let's keep it moving along. Andrew, tell us a little bit about your history with gaming, buddy.
Mine's pretty close to Dave's. I grew up, playing like the NES stuff, and there was one day whenever my parents dropped me off over at my uncle's house, my aunt and uncle's house, and he had a I think it was a 486 at the
Son of
time.
a
Is it?
bitch.
Yeah, sorry, one up, buddy. I think it was a 486, but he showed me how to load up a game called Doom and DOS.
Doom.
And
What, which one was it? Doom? I don't know if I've heard of that one.
Yeah, I know,
yeah.
right?
I think you're crazy.
Dude, that was
it's really,
the
really
sci-fi,
obscure.
The sci-fi thing with the desert and the worms, right?
Yeah,
I love
that's
Dune.
right. Yeah.
Shut up, Dave. And so whenever we first loaded this up, I was like, holy shit, like this is crazy. Like this is it was just completely next level stuff for me, and like I carried that with me the entire time while playing games like Duke 3D, which I totally love. Blood, Hexen Heretic, Power Slave was a big one for me.
Yeah.
Like anything that came in those PC gamer like demos from
Demo
like
discs, the Max
from
from
like
PC, the Max from
totally
PC demo discs that had like Forsaken and shit
absolutely.
on it. Ugh,
Anything that had those on it, I'd play the shit out of because like we kind of like my family kind of grew up a little like somewhat a little broke while we were coming up. But time moved on, things got a little bit better, and I started buying some of these old retro games that I never got the full versions for. But those PC game discs, man, I totally jammed the shit out of. But I did have full versions of Quake, Duke 3D, and Doom. So
I miss those
that's
games,
where,
man. Demo discs, those are
yeah,
the best.
they were the shit. Going into Electronic Boutique,
Well,
and
that's
they
how you
have like.
found out about games, because we didn't have the internet, so there wasn't like, you couldn't. So that's how you found out about new games to buy, and then you'd play the demos, and you'd have to hold your parents to drag you to CompUSA. Remember CompUSA?
Yeah,
So
CompUSA, man.
and you'd buy games in the fucking big box. I still remember I got caught walking out of CompUSA, and the beeper went off outside the thing, and my dad's like, "What happened?" The guy, and I pulled Duke Nukem Plutonium Pack out of my pants. I was like 11 years old. I stole it from the store, and I was like, "I'm sorry," and I'll never forget. He smacked the shit out of me right in front of everybody at the store, and I never got caught stealing again.
Yeah, I think I probably played the MDK demo. There was a thing that came from the Harvey Norman games. I think I played the MDK demo more than I played MDK, like the full game when I finally bought it. Like, I just spent so much time with it, yeah. Kids these days,
man.
Yeah.
A lot of times the demos were better than the full games.
Yeah, well, more addictive, I think, because you kind of got so used to playing it repetition over and over, I suppose, yeah.
The Resident Evil time demo. The Resident Evil time demo. I just played it as fast as I could.
Yep.
It's just like I'm gonna go as fast as long as I can with this. Oh my god.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was me growing up. Those were my games for sure.
David, what about you?
Well, I had actually a bit of a strange, gaming history when I was younger because, I didn't ever have a console. When I was a kid, I think the first console we got was GameCube, and that was when I was a, that was when I was a, when I was a teenager. So I actually grew up playing. When I was really young, I played, the edutainment games.
Yeah, of course.
Math Blaster and stuff.
Yeah, Math Blaster.
Fucking love Math Blaster.
Yeah, and then when I was like a young teenager, I got really into programming in QBasic, and so what I actually did was I was playing a lot of other people's QBasic games that they'd just be on these different sites and you download. So that's actually a lot of, I have these weird, like, nostalgic memories of these games no one else has ever played because I played those. And then along with that, I started getting a hold of, FPS shareware, different, like Doom, Duke, all the games everyone else mentioned.
Yeah, all the essentials.
And this was actually kind of around the time when, like, Halo 2 was that was the new
the
big
shit,
thing,
yeah.
And none of our computers would, or our computer would not run anything anywhere near current. So I was like playing these games from pretty way earlier than I probably should have actually been playing them because of how old I am, because our computer wouldn't run anything else. And so I kind of grew up playing all these FPS shareware games, and then eventually moved into actually buying the full games whenever I had money to buy them. And so it was a lot of old FPSs. That's how I kind of fell in love with them. And then That love just continued.
Yeah. Yeah, it seems to be like a kind of recurring theme. I've spoken to a lot of people, and that shareware model that you kind of got in the 90s seems to be like most people's introductions, especially to Doom. Like, I don't think I knew anyone who went straight into the full version. It was shareware, play the shit out of that, and then somehow you ended up getting the full version. Like, if your parents bought it.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't have the...
Yeah.
Which was funny, especially when we were making Rise of the Triad, we found out most people thought they had, you know, played Rise of the Triad, but they only ever played The Hunt Begins.
Yeah.
Which
yeah.
arguably is better than the rest of the game, because the other 60 levels of Rise of the Triad, and Tom Hall will admit this, are just kind of a mess.
Yeah. You know
they
what?
Are.
I mean,
isn't that kind of all...
Mm.
That kind of the case with all of them?
Yeah.
It's like the shareware is the best part of the game. Like, I mean, Doom Episode 1 is like the best episode.
A lot of people love Doom, you know, Episode 4 and then Doom 2 and stuff. I think everything after Doom 1 Episode 3 is just kind of just like throwing shit at the wall and, you know, seeing what sticks. You know, I'm way bigger fan. Like, I feel like Doom 1 Episodes 1 through 3 are absolutely perfect. Once you get to Thy Flesh Consumed and beyond, it's just, they were just kind of just getting ridiculous. Like, yeah. I'm not a huge fan of Doom 2. I'm not a huge fan of the Super Shotgun. I'll play Doom 1 all day. Doom 2, don't go back to it that
much. Sacrilegious.
Yeah. I think the problem with Doom 2, the problem with Doom 2 and with Episode 4, I think, is that I'm pretty sure they had a bunch of people working on those episodes. You've got Episode 1 and Ramiro just smashed the whole thing out, and it's just got this consistency. And I think the first episode is the best like Doom's ever been.
Absolutely.
Like, the pacing, the level, the lighting. And you run that in GZ Doom or something, and it still looks fucking amazing, man. On high res, it's a perfect sort of, I don't know, it's like the quintessential old school FPS, just that one episode.
It's the Black Album of FPS shooters. Like,
that's
that
it.
One thing is the Black Album of FPS shooters. That just the knee deep in the dead. That's it.
Yeah.
Remember when Metallica was that member?
So
shut up.
Look, talking about Rise of the Triad. How did you guys end up? I mean, like, how did the remake come about? Like, that's a good kind of segue to get into that.
I've told this story a bunch, but I'll tell it again. I think literally every podcast I've ever been on, I tell this story. So, back in the day around 20, how I ended up in asked backwards in the video game industry was I was blogging. You know, I was playing WoW, I was blogging, I was working at a car dealership at the time, and I was blogging at a website called Rip10, and I started covering. You know, I love to write about PC games and stuff. So, you know, I was like, hey, man, let me cover PC games. I'll write about all this stuff. These dudes in Denmark and this guy, Fred, he released some screens and stuff. He was trying to remake Duke 3D in Unreal Engine. It was called Duke 3D Reloaded.
This. Yeah, I remember this.
And he was, you know, he had the website up. He had a team together, and he had like a crowdfunding thing.
Yeah.
This was way before the cease and desist. I was like the first person to throw money at. I was like, hey, I'd love to interview you guys for this site. You know, I think I donated like $200 to the cause. I was like the top donator. Andrew, you remember those days when people were listed on the site like Kings of Duke and, you know, Silver Level, and, you know, for anybody who donated, you know, they got a few thousand bucks that way. And I was super into it as a, you know, huge Duke 3D fan. And, you know, obviously seeing Fred's screenshots and everything in Unreal Engine was like, holy shit, I want, you know, this project to be a thing. Eventually they got, you know, obviously everyone knows the story. They got shut down by Gearbox with the IP issues and stuff. It was greenlit and then subsequently ungreenlit. But Fred at that point had a team together and he had some clout, you know, and I had a marketing background and stuff, and he knew I was super interested. So I had moved on at the time. I was writing for like PC Gamer and Kotaku and stuff. You know, I had still been writing, but I was looking to like move on and use my marketing degree and, you know, get an actual job, you know, because writing about games is an actual job. We all know that. Mm. just kidding. If you're listening, Polygon. He asked me, he's like, hey, Dave, should I do the Fred voice?
Go for it. Best impersonation.
It is. He goes, Dave, you know, we have to, he's Danish. I make him sound like Schwarzenegger. He's like, we can't work on the Duke project anymore, but we got contacted by this legendary publisher, legendary. And, we loved you when you wrote about us, and we know you're a big fan, and we know a lot of people. So if you'd want to get involved, you know, I'd love to have you talk to this legendary publisher we're working with, and we're talking about doing something really, really cool. And I was like, shit, man, sure, why not? You know, I'd sound like, you know, worst, best case scenario would be something cool to get involved with. Worst case would be a good story, right, for PC Gamer or whatever. Mm. And that publisher turned out to be Apogee, not the old Apogee, but the new Apogee that our buddy Terry and some other guys had spun off from Scott Miller in, I think, what was it, like 2009? something like that. Yes, yeah, so they, you know, they brought back the Apogee name, and they had gotten the rights to some IPs and stuff. And at the time, what they wanted to do was another Duke game. And they, you know, they pitched me this, hey, we want to do this other Duke game, because back then they still had, you know, there was some weird rights issues where Apogee had rights to do like a couple of Duke games for consoles. Some, there was all kinds of weird shit going on with it. You'd have to ask Scott Miller to get like the whole story. Like, I don't think anybody actually knows what was going on with the Duke IP in those days. But I told him, I was just like, you know, I, this doesn't seem like the project for me, you know, because, you know, right, this was right after Duke Forever had come out. And I was like, I don't know if, you know, I want to be involved with anyone making a Duke game right now. The IP is not really doing so hot, you know, especially so I don't know what's going on with the rights and stuff. And we were about to get off the phone, and I was like, literally, as we're about to get off the phone, you know, I was like, hey, wait a second. You guys own rights to Rise of the Triad? And he and Terry was like, yep. And I was like, well, you doing anything with that? And he was like, well, not really. I was like, well, why don't we fucking do that? And Fred was like, I love Rise of the Triad. Yeah, we could totally make that game. My guys love that game.
You need to see Irani in person for me.
We could do that game for X amount of dollars. It's great. Come on, do it. We'll do it. I love Rise of the Triad. Come on, do it. I actually did that voice in the game. Remember Big John, the boss, and anyone else too? That was
I had to cut those up. Yeah.
Yeah. I did. That was the best VO I ever did. And it was like, and the rest is kind of history. We started working on it immediately. Fred came up with a design doc, you know, and it took us about a year and a half. And next thing you know, we had a full... It was originally, I think what we wanted to do was like an HD remake, you know, kind of like almost a source port, you know, because there's WinRot, but WinRot was never, you know, it wasn't full on. You know, anybody who knows WinRot knows it's good, but it's not great.
Yeah.
And I kind of, we kind of wanted to do an HD thing, and it ended up turning into a full-blown Unreal Engine 3 reboot and, you know, it came out, did pretty well, but that's how it just kind of happened, you know. And Andrew, I remember at the time, and I wrote a blog about this. Andrew wasn't always the choice to do the music. I had, at that point, I'm good friends with Danny Baranowski, you know, the guy who did the music for Super Meat Boy and Binding of Isaac, and what's the one with the dancing thing that he won a bunch of awards for?
Crypt of the Necrodancer.
Crypt of the Necrodancer, yeah. And I was good friends with him, and I was actually talking to Danny about doing the soundtrack for Rot, and then Andrew had sent a bunch of samples in to Fred, and he sent them over to me because I became like the lead, you know, one of the lead dudes on it. And I heard Andrew's music, and I was like, oh, no, let's use the metal guy. Because it was originally going to be a lot more like Danny's style, you know, a lot more chiptune type synthy stuff with a little bit of metal. But as soon as like we heard Andrew's stuff, as soon as I heard Andrew's, you know, Grab Bag remake, I was like, this could be the dude.
Yeah.
And it's funny because if you go back and listen to your stuff from back then, oh man, you've come a long way.
Rise of the Triads, Rise of the Triads a weird game, man. It's one of those things where, like you say, like I know there's a couple of different versions of it, but just the whole concept of it and the timing when it came out was very strange. Like,
yeah.
FPSs had kind of progressed past that kind of maze thing, and then you had this kind of strange game with this really weird sort of tongue-in-cheek, I don't know, atmosphere.
Like the weirdest, you know, you can go on, but like it got trapped in the weirdest part, like after Doom, before build engine stuff, but like after Doom stuff, and I think that's why it became such a cult thing, because
it was so bizarre.
Like, yeah. It had so many cool features, but it was so like behind in the times. Like it had already been surpassed, and next thing you knew, Quake was out, and like no, you know, and Rot was super dated. It was just, it's a weird game in so many ways. I think that's why so many people love it, though.
Yeah, you know what?
Yeah, because it was like, just weird in design, and then it was archaic when it came out. So it's this weird combination of things that makes it this.
You know, I didn't notice the IP Freely joke until the remake came out, and someone pointed it out to me. Yeah, because I was a kid when I played it, and I didn't really play that much, and then I saw the remake, and I said, hang on a sec, Ian Paul Freely, and it all kind of clicked. It just works on so many levels, you know? It's amazing.
It's really deep.
So third grade.
Adult sophisticated humor. It's fun. It's a fun IP, because especially when we were doing the reboot and just, you know, going forward, just you could do kind of whatever you want with it. It's so wacky, you know, like you could turn into a dog. There's a magical baseball bat.
Yeah.
There's just, you know, and but at the time it was so cool. I mean, there were five playable characters with different health. You had 11 player multiplayer. You had, you know, room on room stuff. There, you know, and people think that Rot was a Doom clone in the Doom engine. It was using the fucking Wolf 3D engine.
Yeah, it's
and they were. They were doing stuff with the Wolf 3D engine that nobody had any right to do with that engine at that point.
Yeah, sure. I remember the jump pads at the time were pretty hectic, and you're sitting there collecting these things as you're flying through the air. Like, we didn't really have that happening in FPS at the time. I don't think it was around that time.
Yeah, like Mario-style coins and stuff, and we had to have that stuff in the reboot, which I think I love that stuff. I love, like, the coin collecting and trying 100% the levels and stuff. Yeah. It's just, I don't know, it's just, it's so weird in so many ways. I don't know, I love Rise of the Triad more than anybody has a right to love Rise of the Triad.
You know,
not Tom Hall.
I still remember my dad not catching me, but I remember playing it, and there's those guys in the game who drop to their knees and beg not to be killed.
Yeah. No, please,
I still remember my dad just walking past. He had to walk past that exact moment as I gunned this guy down with the machine gun. My dad just flipping his lid, and before that it was Wolfenstein 3D, but you look back at it now, I mean, the type of shit we get in games these days is just, the violence is just on another level, you know?
Yeah. Well, yeah. I couldn't. I mean, and we did that with the reboot with the first thing. I think it was in the first trailer we ever put out. We had the guy on his knees going, "No, please don't shoot." We used the old soundbite from 95.
Yeah, it's great.
And it's scary with, like, modern visuals. Like, holy shit, I'm about to execute this guy in the face.
Yeah.
Whoever made that trailer,
his arm flies off.
We made that trailer the night before in Fred's hotel room. It was me, Fred, and Terry in Fred's hotel room at QuakeCon. The reveal of the game was the next morning, and we didn't have a trailer yet, and we barely had a game. We'd been working on the game for like 5 months. We had like two levels. There was no AI. If you go back and watch that trailer, none of the enemies are moving, and they don't say anything.
Because
we had no animations or AI yet. It was just, oh my god, that trailer is such BS. I mean, we used what we had, you know. But it was like, holy shit, I still can't believe we cobbled it together and that people liked it. Like, I go back and I've watched it recently and I'm like, this is awful.
I just talked about this on talk earlier, for sure.
I can't believe we got away with that. I remember, and the thing that everyone talks about in that trailer is, like, we didn't have any shots to use. I'm like, I got an idea. Like, what's the coolest thing we have in the game right now? I'm like, the dual pistol reload. I'm going to put slow-mo in. I'm going to jump over the spike pit and do the dual pistol reload, and we'll put that in the trailer because it'll look like I'm doing something. Or there was that one scene where you shoot the flame wall at the truck. I'm like, there was nobody in the truck, so we placed, like, a guy in the truck. It's like, he made it look like he was sitting on the truck. And they were like, all right, ready, go. And, you know, and I slow-mo jumped towards the truck and I shot the flame wall. We're like, boom, perfect. And there were no enemy sounds yet. So all the screams you hear in that trailer, we added in fucking After Effects. When they're like, blah, blah, blah. Those weren't in the game yet. So we had to add all that. I can't believe we made that trailer work. I mean, we had been working on the game for like 3 months. And it was playable on the floor. We made that game play, which was, everything that happened with that game was a fucking miracle.
Miracle. Yes, miracle.
It's a test. But it couldn't have happened any other way, you know, because Rise of the Triad, it has to be like that. It's got to be held together with fucking
I don't think I've ever been more excited. I remember trying to run on my JZ620, honestly.
And just being
it could have been like 5 seconds. Like, just the fact it was like there's a Rise of the Triad reboot, I was losing it.
Yeah.
We didn't expect that. But, like, the reaction it got was nuts. It trended on Twitter for like 2 hours. We're like, what's going on? I couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
And what really sold it was, because originally we wanted to make, I think Fred wanted to make an original song for the trailer. I'm like, no, we have to use Going Down the Fast Way. And I think Andrew, I remember we spent like a month just on fucking Fast Way. You remember that paragraph I wrote you about Fast Way?
Like, pretend
that Mike Portnoy is chasing you down the hallway.
Mike Portnoy is chasing you down the hallway.
Throwing cymbals at you with double machine gun. And I barely knew Andrew at this point. He's like, this guy's fucking crazy.
Oh, dude, I was talking to Terry back and forth, and I was like, this guy's fucking nuts, and you're gonna have to keep a distance between me and him because he's crazy.
The soundtrack's what makes it so kind of cultish, man, and the weapons too. But that soundtrack, like when you start level one and that bass just kicks in, man. Like you're playing Rise of Triad.
Yeah,
you know?
I mean, that was, I think. I mean, you know, I don't know that many people to argue with me. I think that is definitely Lee Jackson's best work.
Yeah, I've actually said that in my review, the Rise of Triad, and I said it's his best, along with Shadow Warrior, I think. Masterpieces of video
Shadow
game
Warrior
music,
stuff's really good. The Duke stuff, I mean, Grab Bag is obviously, like, the most classic thing he ever did, but I think the Rot stuff, just all-encompassing, is definitely his best video game work. And Bobby did a few tracks, too, but I think that, you know, that soundtrack, for the most part, was all Lee. And, you know, and there's stuff on there that, like, shouldn't work. Stuff like, what's the Samba track that I cannot remember the name for myself for the life of me now?
Which one?
Not Adagio. Hang on.
Adagio shouldn't work in that game.
Adagio shouldn't work either. Classical music shouldn't work.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't remember the goddamn.
It's like weird upright piano with like
Havana Smooth.
Yeah,
Havana
that
Smooth
shouldn't
should not work. Doon 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 doon. Like that slow bass line, and yep. It comes in, you know, with the ride cymbal. Like that shouldn't be FPS. Your FPS music was supposed to be like Doom. You know, it's supposed to sound like Metallica.
Yeah.
And now we've got like smooth samba music, and you combine that with turning into a dog and biting a guy in the nuts and barking, and everybody on screen explodes. And it just for some reason it fucking works, and that's why Rot is so
it's
cool.
It's glorious.
You know?
Yeah.
It's just glorious.
Yeah. So, I mean, look, obviously, when we're playing Dusk, you've kind of marketed it from this perspective, but Dusk kind of takes influence from these old games, I guess. I guess
sure.
The main kind of vibes I'm getting is Redneck Rampage and Blood, I think, above all else in terms of the setting and the tone, right?
Because you've only seen episode one, and that is very Redneck Rampage Blood. Once you get to episode two, it's going to feel very Black Mesa, and then episode three is like Sandy Peterson, Quake 1, you know, episode four, like all day long.
Okay, so in terms of the episode, then how long do you think we can expect each one to go for? If I can start kind of jumping in with questions here,
I think what are we up to in episode one? Like, I think we're like 10 levels per episode, pretty much. So like, probably
That's what we're shooting for.
Yeah,
yeah. So it's gonna the whole game is gonna be like 30 plus ish levels.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Single player.
Okay, David, I got to ask you this too, because I was looking up the stuff games you've kind of made in the past, and obviously your portfolio, if you will, is a little bit different to Dusk. So how did you go from making these kind of games, man, to just going straight into Dusk? Like, it's because it's a pretty big jump, you know, honestly.
Yeah, well, I have very specific and very eclectic tastes in games because I really like exploration and puzzle solving, which is why, you know, most of my previous games that are on Steam are like narrative-focused horror exploration games. They're basically walking sims.
Mm.
But I also really, really love shooting stuff.
Yeah.
So I did, you know, I did the walking sim thing for a while.
I love shooting stuff. David Szymanski, 2017.
Yeah, we'll quote
you
on that.
Soundbite. Yeah. So I made the horror games for a while. I don't know, 2 years, something like that. And I just kind of got to a point where I was feeling burnt out on just making kind of the same sort of game all the time, and not seeing it wasn't that I was not seeing a great reaction from people. It was more like every game I made got less and less actual attention from people.
Yeah,
and I was feeling less and less happy with them. Just, you know, generally getting burnt out on it. And I've wanted to make, well, not just a retro FES, but this game specifically since I was like 14. Like, that's actually where the name Dusk came from, 14-year-old David.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah, you told that to, who was it that did that big interview with you? Killscreen, right?
I don't remember. I think so. Yeah.
Yeah, where you talked about
I've told that. Yeah, I've told this. I think it was Killscreen was the first one. And I think I actually have like old quote design documents for Dusk in a binder somewhere.
Oh, we gotta see those.
So, I'm gonna dig them out and like scan them or something just to show people what I thought the next big game was gonna be.
Because I know the general response that we got from the game, like I did that video that you guys might have seen, like the preview or the pre beta, whatever you call it. And the response was like fucking nuts, man. Like I got so many people, because we have a Discord server as well for the channel, and just people, like Matto was one of them, he wouldn't shut up about it until he finally got one. Just people just asking.
Which was yesterday, by the way.
Yeah, which was yesterday.
Like I tried my hardest to get a Dusk key. I tried kissing Dave's ass on Twitter and got no reply. I was devastated. I watched that many gameplay videos, and like as soon as I played it yesterday, man, my life changed.
But that was the response. You know, it's probably about, what, maybe a 10-15 minute demo, a little bit longer if you really try and find everything, but people just went nuts. And I think, like, you're really kind of tapping into something.
We have people that have played the alpha for 40 hours on Steam already.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's surprising. Yeah, there's one guy on the... Yeah.
You go ahead. And then one guy that there's people that have 40, 50 hours, and there's guys that keep speed running the level. One guy's got it down to what, a minute and 2 seconds?
Jeez.
He uploaded a video.
Yeah, glitchless is a minute and two. Glitched is significantly shorter because
you
can
20
just
seconds. You can jump out of the level with a box level, or whatever.
Yeah,
and we
he just
like,
hops on a box and flies.
I feel like it's gonna do great at like ADGQ,
AGDQ, SGDQ,
yeah,
and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah. That'll be fucking great. I mean, and like, there's certain stuff we're gonna, you know, when we have episode one, we let people break it. Certain stuff you want to fix, and then certain stuff where it's like, no, that's great. That's a great exploit.
I was gonna say that. Yeah, like there's certain things in there.
Let the speedrunner speedrun. You know, let them glitch it out. You know,
exactly.
I love the glitchless. Yeah. I'm like, when I watched the Doom 2016, AGDQ, I was like, fucking, you know, he spent all this time trying to glitch through the door. I'm like, just do the gore nest. Fucking shoot something.
Yeah. they break the fucking shit out of that game.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, it's like that.
Yeah, I'm
go ahead, David.
I'm the same way. I'm like, my philosophy for the game is if it makes it more fun, it's not getting fixed. Mm. So like,
yeah.
Prop jumping is fun. That's not getting fixed because I want people to prop jump.
Yeah.
I may put in invisible walls so they can't break everything, but, you know.
Well, with the Y-axis being unlocked, it's really cool, too. We've had people play the entire alpha on their head, like upside down, bouncing on their head. We've had people doing the run with just cigars, doing the run with just a bar of soap. And it's one level, and it's not even – and the game's come so far since then. Like, we're – I think by the time PAX East rolls around in March, we'll have all of episode one pretty much done, and then, you know, 2 to 3 endless levels. And then, like I told Dave when we started working on this, we're just going to build it one brick at a time, one level at a time. You know, right now we've just been iterating, going back and forth, you know, E1, L1, E1, L2, E1, L3. When we're happy with it, we go to the next level, and then we'll go back and we'll iterate some more. And then we'll let the community test it, and we'll just keep on going until we have a full-on campaign with 3 full episodes and, you know, and boss fights and all that stuff. Probably 4 bosses, you know, when you have a big bad boss at the end. And then, you know, and then we'll flesh out the endless mode. And then we'll, you know, start working on multiplayer. And then maybe we'll get co-op going. And then maybe we'll get a level editor going. You know, but it's cool. Just literally, like, one brick at a time. And it's because there's been such a response, like, there's that in the back of your head. You're like, just fucking put it out. Put on early access, fucking, you know, take the money.
No, don't do that.
Know?
Don't do that. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. But we don't want to, because we want to make sure it's a full fucking experience. And, you know, we think, and especially with, you know, the kind of people that play these games, you know, it's a different kind of consumer than the people who play like the survival crafting games on Steam that are used to, like, you know, early access stuff. Like, we're older, you know, we want like complete experiences. We're happy to pay like, you know, a decent amount of money for a full on fucking game that's not early access.
But
for the people who want it early, you know, we've made it pretty easy. You know, all you gotta do is basically, you know, join the community, get in our Discord. I drop keys in there all the time.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's if people want to, you know, break our game that early and see it that early, I'm gonna let them. Plus, you know, it helps us with the game because they find people like speedrunners and stuff will find issues and bugs and stuff that we'll never find.
Yeah.
You know, so it's invaluable to have like all these people in our Discord like helping us make the game.
Well, Maddo's doing that at the moment for Turok 2. We were talking to Steven, and you know, they're working on the Turok 2 remaster, and even in its current state, it's full of bugs, but it's just amazing how
I've torn that game apart. Yeah. I've found some pretty weird shit.
But improved visuals and modern controls, man, can just really, I don't know, take a sort of an average, or not average, but quite a dated game and kind of propel it, you know, up and just make it still very playable, which is, you kind of get that vibe from Dust. Like, it looks old and you've got that art style, but it just handles and controls like so well. Do you know what I mean?
It feels like, you know, kind of, you know, same as like a, you know, any source port like GZ Doom. But the thing that I've been talking about with Dusk, and I think Dave would agree, is like, you know, if people see it and they think Quake, but you play Dusk and you go back to Quake and the movement in Quake is very limiting comparatively
rigid,
to Dusk.
Yeah.
In Dusk, you've got almost complete control at all times. Like, that's what I feel like your weapon is, you know. And I always think about in things in terms of marketing, you know, and their weapons, you know, the enemy, they've, you know, their weapon is numbers, right? But they're mostly cannon fodder. And your weapon is your one guy, but you've got complete control. You know, you've got complete air control. You know, you can flip upside down. You're 10 times faster than them. You know, your weapons fire faster. And it's just, it's the kind of game where if you think you can go somewhere, you usually can. There's a way to get there. If you think you can jump to something, you can. If you think you can, you know, it's just, it's not limiting at all, especially. And I think, you know, we've gotten a little bit of blowback, like a very little bit, like four comments on Reddit saying like the move, because David has said, you know, the skill based movement is like a lot easier to pull off than Quake, which I appreciate it because I can't bunny hop and strafe jump in Quake. Like I'm not Rafa, like I'm not that. It's hard to do.
Yeah.
In Dusk, like anybody can, you know, pull that stuff off if it's there, and it feels good. It feels good to think like, I wonder if I can bunny hop and go faster. And you start doing it, and you're like, wow, I can. I feel like a pro Quake player, even though I suck, you know. And it's just fun to have that much freedom of, you know, movement and control. But it looks old, but it plays really new, you know. And the thing is, you go back to like games like Doom. I don't know when the last time you guys have played Doom that wasn't like GZ Doom, but like. Oh, I forgot how limiting it was. Yeah. I've gotten so used to WASD and mouse look that like I forgot how to play with arrow keys and control and stuff like that. I forgot you couldn't look around, you know, originally in Doom, because I've gotten so used to source ports.
It's more the resolution, I think, that kind of makes that not play as well. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, and it's evocative, you know. There's just something about when you start playing Dusk, it feels like you feel it in the back of your head. It's almost like it's like a muscle memory, and it's like, it's not like when like a smell or a taste brings you back to your childhood. Like for me, it's always like whenever I smell cigars, it reminds me of my old man, because my old man smoked cigars, right? When I first started playing Dusk, I immediately remembered parts of Redneck Rampage that I had not thought about since I was like 13 years old.
Yeah.
Like immediately in the back of my head, I remembered like level one of Redneck. I was like, what does this feel like? And then I was like, holy shit, this feels like level one of Redneck Rampage. Like, we're onto something here, you know?
Mm.
Yeah, that's I've played just about every FPS from like mid to late 90s that I can get my hands on, and I've put a little bit of most of them in Dusk somewhere. It's like a little, oh, this looks like this game, or this kind of plays like this game, or that sort of thing, because that's my genre. That's what I love, and Dusk is like, it's not going for like just taking little bits of things like, oh, you know, Doom was fast and had arcadey combat, so we'll just take that and that will make our game like Doom. It's like, I'm trying to take everything and put it all together into something. So it's not just like arenas that you fight enemies in. It's like you get the whole exploring a complex level, finding keys, finding secrets.
You just want to make the dirty love child of every FPS game.
I mean, basically,
yeah.
And when we came out with it, you know, I was thinking of how to market this thing, you know, with the trailer and stuff. And I was like, we literally just need to beat people over the head and tell people, like, you like Quake? You like this. You like Doom? You fucking like this. You like Redneck Rampage? Congratulations. We made a game for you.
Yeah.
You know, and just kind of throw it out there. And my, you know, my buddy was like, you sure you want to say that? Because, you know, people are going to think that you're, you know, what if you're trying to say that, you know, you're better than these old games? And I'm like, no. We just want to let people know that this game is literally inspired by every game, every FPS that you grew up playing in the 90s. It's going to remind you of all of them, but it's going to feel like a new game. It's not going to be limiting in any way. You know, we've got I think we've got as many graphic options as like the Sirius engine at this point, you know.
And another priority is, you know, it's a tightrope to walk, cuz I want to try and capture as much of those old games as possible, but without just making another Quake or like a rehash of, you know, it needs to feel familiar, but it also needs to feel like it has its own personality and it's fresh and new and, you know, something you actually want to spend money on instead of just going back and playing like, the games.
Why don't I just play, you know, Source Ports of Quake and stuff? So, yeah, we got to make something that feels new. But it's cool because, like, we've got graphics options that let you, you know, make a tiny window. You know how you could, you know, if you hit that the plus and minus keys, you could make the window really tiny, you know, where it would say, like, buy a 486 in ROT and then turn the pixelization all the way up so it looks like you're playing on 386, or turn the graphics options all the way up so it looks like you're playing, like, on a proper, like, Source Port, you know?
Yeah.
And that's, we and every option in between, you can play in black and white, you can play in, you know, sepia tones, you can, I don't know, are we going to add blood?
Tons of color options.
Yeah, Andrew.
Yeah, that should probably be in there.
I was gonna say to Andrew too, like in terms of the music, like, are you picking a specific game, or again, are you gonna kind of just pick and choose from different kind of staples of the genre? I suppose.
That's kind of a thing where I'm going more based off of the tone from it, and a lot of it's being pulled from like Blood and Quake and stuff like that.
Mm.
It's not one of those things where I'm gonna, you know, I'm not specifically gonna go to like something like Wolfenstein and, you know, like this is, I'm using this opportunity kind of to get my Nine Inch Nails out of my system.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
A little bit more.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot. Well. Yeah, a lot of Quake, a lot of Doom 64, a lot of brutal Doom 64. Speaking of stuff you've worked on, but I think we reference Trent Reznor a lot. And Sasha,
there's some Meshuggah, there's some Meshuggah feels in there for sure.
Yeah,
wherever you come up to some bigger stuff.
Because there's a lot of atmospheric stuff, but then with like the boss battles in big rooms, Andrew's really ramping it up in kind of a Doom 2016 sort of way, where it's just there's going to be some real balls to the wall metal sections in there too, which I mean we just love because we're into that shit.
Yeah. I suppose too. Like, I was actually kind of surprised that it's almost like a horror game. Well, I guess it is horror, right? Like this, especially the first few bits of the beta, and then once you start getting super shotguns and rivet guns and stuff, and you're just blowing people to pieces, it just kind of takes on a different tone. So, I mean, is that going to be consistent, or is it going to be like a sort of a sci-fi vibe, or and then it's going to be kind of military action kind of stuff? I mean, is it going to keep changing, or?
It's going to be pretty consistently horror-y throughout. I mean, Doom was a horror game when it came out.
Yep.
Like, that was what horror looked like.
Mm.
Quake was, so it's like... Yeah, it's gonna be
fucking scary. What are those fucking flying sons of bitches? And the things that stick to the wall and the ceiling? Fuck those things. The first time you see a shambler, even today, it's like, nope.
Yeah.
Well, they're getting pretty easy with a super nail gun, but yeah, go on, sorry, Dan.
Yeah.
Oh, the settings will be changing. We're going from rural farmlands, and then we're going into the, stalker-y, Black Mesa-y, factories and industrial complexes, and then going into just crazy, insane Lovecraft weirdness. But the atmosphere of, it's dark, it's gritty, it's just disgusting looking, and that's all going to stay pretty consistent.
Yeah. Enemy-wise, too, the enemy's going to be changing, or is it going to be the similar roster?
They're going to be changing.
Okay. Oh yeah,
they're going to change based.
Yeah, we're adding new enemies all the time. We actually just did. Did you guys watch The Witch?
No,
unfortunately, no.
Okay, well, anyway, there's a goat in that movie. His name's Black Phillip.
I've seen this. Yeah.
Yeah. So we needed a new fodder enemy, because the soldiers were the fodder. The one shot kind of dumb enemies. But they didn't work in episode one because soldiers don't really have any place on the farm. Those are more episode two enemies. So we needed something. And originally, what were we thinking of? I was like, demon dogs, I was like, dogs that shoot acid or something. And then I was like, wait a second, what about, devil goats that spit blood at you? And then I was like, wait, Black Phillip. Let's make Black Phillips that run around and shoot at you. So now we've got half-dead demon goats in episode one. And they're my new favorite enemy to kill.
Amazing.
They're great.
They are fun.
We're adding stuff all the time. And it's cool because it's such a small team. It's basically just the three of us that we just, we come up with something and it's in the game the next day. And, if it's cool, it's cool. If it's not, we, work on something else.
Yeah.
I noticed one thing you guys nailed is the aspect of what the fuck am I walking into? Because I remember that there's a house where you get the yellow key. And just walking outside, you hear the chainsaws. I'm like, what the fuck am I about to experience?
Yeah. That was the first enemy we redesigned, I think. I think I suggested, I was like, what about a dude with a chainsaw and a bag on his head? And the next day you had like the, what we call the leathernecks now. And Dave does all the sound work too. And I remember the first
Andrew
time you
hear
some,
it. Andrew does some, I do most of it.
It's mostly Dave.
Yeah, you hear them, the heavy breathing and the chainsaw, and I was like, oh my god, that's terrifying. Because you can hear them, through walls, and it's great, because you could hear the pinky demons and imps in Doom, around the corner and stuff, so you know they're there.
Yep.
It's the same thing with the leathernecks. You hear that, you know they're going to be there, and you know they're tough. They're easy to get around, but they have a lot of health. So, if you hear one, you're like, okay, one of these motherfuckers is around here somewhere. I'm going to open a door, and he's going to pop out at me, and go all leatherface with the chainsaw over his head. And it's, the first time that happened, I was like, this is perfect, this is great. It's the best enemy ever, and the same thing with Scarecrow with a shotgun, which I'm taking all the credit for because I'm pretty sure that was my idea.
No, that was my idea.
The first time it happens, and which we're still working on in the actual game, but the first time it happens and watching people play, especially Jim Sterling, when the first time he ran into one and he loses his mind, he's like, holy shit, game of the year, that's a fucking Scarecrow with a shotgun, it came to life.
That's a good Sterling. That's a pretty good Sterling, that's pretty spot on.
Uncanny.
Yeah. And it's and I was like just watching people like experience like how you hope they're going to in your head.
Yep.
Is great. Like when Dave designed, like, okay, it stands there, and not all the scarecrows come to life, which so it fucks with you. Yeah. Like sometimes you assume they're gonna come to life, and they doesn't, and then one does, and just you know, the jump scare. Plus, they're tough as hell, and they have shotguns with a really wide spread. Just watching that happen and going like, yes, you know, it's just it's fun to like you know come up with those ideas that we come up with in like our Slack channel, and then watch people experience them the way we want to, and be like, yay, we did a game design.
It's like a Baron of Hell moment in End of Doom 1. You know, when you kind of walk up that elevator, and then two of them come out, and you've never seen them before. Yeah, I can see where you guys are going with it. In terms of weapons, someone asked me to. In terms of guns, what we got in the beta, are we going to have the same thing in the full version? Are there going to be more guns, or are you going to just kind of play around with what you've got? What's the story there?
What do we get to blow shit up with?
Yeah, what's the what is there going to be a sort of a BFG as well? You're kind of working on a super secret, you know, kill everything in the room kind of gun.
Are we? It's really hard to say. I mean, at the moment we're pretty happy with the arsenal, but you don't know what's going to change in the future.
Yeah, yeah.
We've done a lot of iterating on the game already.
Yeah, as we're building it out, like I remember, so the grenade launcher wasn't great, so now the grenade launcher, you can fire them and then explode them. So you fire them with left mouse and explode them with right mouse.
Okay.
So you can leave them and explode them when you want. You can shoot a few and then explode them, which is a lot more fun. It's very evocative of the stuff we did in the Rot reboot with the alt fires. I mean, the Riveter is basically a rocket launcher, and it's fun. It's just, you know, it feels really good right now, but I think also we're really still kind of in episode one mode. As we get into 2 and 3... maybe we'll get into some more supernatural stuff, but like, you know, it's whatever we think feels good. And, you know, Dave might just come up, you know, one day and be like, so I came up with this idea, you know, bear with me here. So it's a bunch of tentacles and, you know, they fire, you know, they shoot stuff all over the way. Then the hentai girls go screaming and it's, you know, I was like, eh, it might work.
Yeah. But suddenly the game is something very different.
Yeah. Yeah.
What are you talking about? H-Doom is fucking the Sonny Jr.'s most popular video that he's ever made. It's clearly something that people want. People want more hentai in their FPS.
It's funny because, I mean, I've done games like Doom, I've done GoldenEye, I've done Half-Life, I've done arguably like the most important FPS games, right? And then I make a mod for a video for hentai Doom or whatever, and it gets a million fucking views. I can't figure it out. The YouTube algorithm is just beyond me. I don't understand it. You know?
And it's funny.
Super
people
easy to figure out. It has boobs in the front.
That's it. Yeah.
It's been around for a while, but it's just so funny watching people. Like, it's getting reported on by like big out. Like Kotaku wrote a story about H Doom the other day. Oh god, yeah. Kotaku has discovered H Doom. Everybody run for the hills.
Everyone run.
But they spoke about it favorably, and Kotaku were normally they rip things apart, man. They made fun of Far Cry 3 Blood Dragon because it was some passing remark that someone thought was homophobic. I mean, clutch at straws, yeah.
But at the same time, I think, you know, H Doom, everybody realizes that it's in good fun and it's kind of ridiculous. And it's, but it's
the shotgun senpai for PC.
Yeah, and it's also, it's just so fucking graphic. It's so hard to, like, it's almost impressive, you know? It is impressive. What he's done with those sprites, that sprite work is actually rather impressive.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, how do you conceptualize fucking a female cyber demon? Well, someone has done it.
But it's done. Yeah, it's done believably, and it makes sense the way they've done it. That's the craziest part about it. You know?
It's terrifying.
Yeah. So we won't get a hentai mod for Dusk, though. Is that what you're trying to say? Is that the long and short of it?
We have no control over whether there's going to be a hentai mod for Dusk. That's in the community's hands.
I mean, knowing our community, it's probably going to be a furry mod first, the hentai mod second.
Yeah. Oh, cool. So, I'm just trying to segue out of that. I don't know where to go from that.
Yeah,
there's no segue. The only segue out of that is to drive a Segway off a cliff.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Just like the guy who owns Segway.
Yeah. Well, that's the end of the podcast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We can't talk. All right,
guys.
Now.
Thanks. It was fun. I'll see you next time.
So, I guess what kind of hinges on the results of Dusk? I mean, like, what's next for you guys once this comes out? Like, were you going to try and get licenses for other games? I know Steven said he's trying to get what was it, Matto, he was saying the other day? Yeah, someone's talking about Blood. They'd been trying to get the rights to that forever. Like, what's kind of next, I suppose?
I mean, I'm good buddies with Steve Kick at Night Dive. We've been friends for a while, and, you know, and the guys at Devolver and stuff. And we all talk about this stuff all the time because we're all into the same games. I mean, Steve's made a career out of resurrecting these old things ever since he got the rights to System Shock, and God bless him, and now with Turok and all the cool shit he's working on. I don't know. What have we talked about? I mean, obviously, I think me and Andrew would like to do more stuff with Rise of the Triad if that ever happens.
Mm.
Yeah.
And I think we all obviously love the idea of Blood, but I mean, everybody wants that. And last I heard, Atari or whoever owns the IP wants so much fucking money for it that it's just insane.
How much are they talking about? Just out of curiosity.
I mean, this was a while ago, and this is just, I'm pulling this out of my ass, but I heard like they were like tens of millions of dollars.
Oh,
for
wow.
IP,
yeah, that's nuts. Yeah.
Which is insane. There's no way. I mean, it's even Blood is a pretty, you know, it's a very, it's a memorable FPS IP, but it's still, it was never one of the bigger ones.
Mm.
You know, I'm hoping, you know, it'd be really cool if, you know, if Monolith and, you know, and Jace got involved again. I mean,
yeah,
you know, Monolith, you know, they're tied to Warner Brothers, but I mean, they've been putting out awesome games. Like, they haven't done an FPS in forever, but, you know, Shadow of Mordor and Mad Max were fucking awesome. If they can find a way to make Blood half as cool as that,
yeah,
I'm in.
Well, the guys who made, I think they made, what was it? They made a game on Steam.
Betrayer.
Yeah, but Betrayer was pretty good. And it was a bunch of guys who actually worked on like Blood and Fear. One of the main guys is Craig Hubbard, I think.
I don't know what happened.
Was that the
to
game
them?
That was black and white, but there was only red?
Yeah, you could change the color filter if you wanted to. Okay. Yeah, yeah. But like, that was a good game, man. And it had like a fixed health thing, and it had a really, you would have probably played it, I guess, David, because of the whole exploration sort of thing about it. But
precisely.
That was a really good game.
Yeah, I love that game
too. Nothing came out of it. I was really kind of hopeful they were going to start, you know, smashing out games again, but it just, I don't know, it just went away and nothing happened. Yeah, it was really sad.
I mean,
a lot of the guys who worked on like Fear went to Black Powder Games and made that, but I don't know what they're doing now.
Mm.
Who knows? I mean, it's just, I mean, there's, it's, I don't know, making, I we haven't really talked, I mean, because we're just so focused on Dusk. I mean, and we'll have to see where Dusk takes us, right? Like, if people get really into the, if people get real, like, I think the first thing after the actual release is making sure we get the, you know, the dev kit out there, the toolkit, which I think what we're already calling Dawn.
Yeah, that'll keep it going forever if you get modding stuff out there.
Yeah,
sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
With Steam Workshop. Well, there's
already a guy who's kind of started working on that, and the game's not even done yet.
Yeah.
So
yeah, God bless the community, man.
Yeah.
You know, my whole thing being, you know, the producer and marketing guy is, you know, give the people what they want, right? If people want more single player, we give them more single player. If they want more multiplayer, we give them more multiplayer. If they want, you know, if they want, you know, more co-op type stuff, we can work on that. If they want a sequel, if it makes sense for us to jump into a sequel, maybe we'll do that. But I mean, like I said, right now we're just focused on level by level, brick by brick, focusing mainly on making the best, you know, campaign we can, because there's not there's not a lot of that. You know, there's a lot of retro stuff, but a lot of it's, you know, it's procedural, or it's roguelike, or it's wave based type stuff, you know.
Yeah, they get skipped over. Like handcrafted level design, I feel like it's skipped over.
Yep.
There's very few examples of it in India, especially.
We live in the age where everybody just wants, you know, co-op and multiplayer and stuff. And, you know, I think the reason why me and Dave and Andrew mesh so well is because we are all very much so single player retro FPS guys.
Mm.
Like neither me or David played hardly any Quake, you know, 3 Arena or Quake Live. We're just not, but we played a shit ton of Quake 1 and 2 and, Quake 4 and stuff. We're single player FPS gamers. And,
you're preaching to the choir,
and there's a lot of us out there. You know, we're not the mass market, but at the same time, the cool thing about being a small team is we don't have to make a game that, you know, for the mass market. We, you know, we don't have to focus on multiplayer or, you know, roguelike or wave based stuff because it sells more. We're going to make the kind of game that we want to play, which is a game about, you know, hunting down keys and secrets and, you know, big open levels with different ways to, you know, to beat them, and campaigns with bosses at the end and boss fights and, you know, that kind of, you know, the games that we've played, you know, the games that like Shadow Warrior, Duke 3D, Blood, Redneck Rampage, you know, Quake 1. You know, so that's what we want to focus on first. And then, like, we're definitely going to do the endless stuff because that's easy. And we're definitely going to do multiplayer because, I mean, a game like with the kind of movement and weapons we have, I feel like multiplayer is just going to end up being so much fun.
It's going to be a blast. Yeah. It's going to be insane.
Yeah. But the focus is, but the focus is a single player.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have no idea what I'm planning on doing after Dusk either.
Hopefully taking a vacation, man.
How long have you guys been working on it? Do you reckon? How long's the cycle?
You're having a baby. You gotta go. You know.
Yeah, I think. Yeah, there'll be some child raising happening after Dusk, and probably during Dusk development. That's going to be interesting.
Yeah.
How long have we worked? Not that long. I think, Dave, you started, what, like the beginning of last year?
It's been about a year for me, because I'm starting to see... I have no sense of time. I'm really bad at it, but I'm starting to see like the annoying Facebook time hop thing being like, here's this screenshot or that you posted a year ago, and I'm like, oh, that was Dusk stuff. So I think it's been about a year, and I think really serious, like since you know you guys got involved, like I don't know.
It's been what? Months. It's like yes, you know, six.
Seven,
when did we?
8 months.
I mean, we
it's
first
like 6-7 months, right around that.
Yeah. But, yeah, the first time we showed it as it is now was QuakeCon last year, and we were working.
And we had been working for a couple months before that.
But
it's like you say, this whole the whole early access model thing. I mean, I'm kind of glad you guys stepped away from it, because I can't really think of any example where early access has paid off, at least not in like a timely sort of fashion.
There's been some great ones, you know, like Darkest Dungeon, you know, shit like that. Stardew Valley, I think, was early access. Factorio. I mean, there's been success stories, but I mean,
out of the thousands that they put out there,
out of the thousands, they're just not.
Well, the big issue I have with it is, I mean, there's like consumer side issues, but the big issue that I have with it as far as just saying, you know, I don't really want to release a game in early access is then people are going to experience the game in its half finished state. And most of those people are never going to come back to see it when it's actually finished.
Exactly. The thing with early access, and I say this as, you know, an investor and marketing guy, is you only get one chance to launch a game.
Yeah.
You know, you launch an early access, your game's out there. Like, can people review it? Yes, they fucking can. You're charging money for it. And the other thing with early access with Dusk is, we don't, you know, early access, you know, what it's intended for is for, you know, companies, small companies to be able to get their games out there, get feedback, testing. We don't need early access for that. We've got a, you know, a Discord with 700 people in it now who are, you know, chomping at the bit to play Dusk, test it for us, give us feedback, give us suggestions. So, you know, we don't need, you know, putting it on early access and getting a bunch of money would be nice, but, you know, we don't need to do that. We don't want to do that, you know? And we're more than happy to let our community take a crack at it. Like, it's the kind of game, like, if you want it early, it's there for you. But, like, we want to present it to the public the first time it's, like, on sale as something that's, like, feels, you know, it feels like it's representative of the full experience of Dusk, and not just something you're going to play a little bit and never come back to and be like, oh, I didn't like it. Because, you know, if people say, you know, they'll come back to it when it's finished, they never do. You know, there's a million early access games I've played. I'm like, oh, I'll play this when it's done or when it's in beta, and I never do. I never come back to it. I played it once.
Yeah, for sure.
And I don't want that to happen with Dusk.
Yeah, it's funny you mention that because Matt and I were just playing through The Forest, you know, that game where you're stuck on an island and there's cannibals. And I haven't played it since it literally first came on Steam, when it was one of those shitty chop down trees, make campfires kind of game. And now there's this massive like subplot in it where there's all these like experiments, and I won't spoil anything.
It's hard to get back.
I would never have touched it, and it's actually a really good game. Like it's so much further than what it was. It's going nuts now apparently, but. No one would have, other people like me who wouldn't know about it and gone back to play it wouldn't have, I don't know, there'd be no interest there long term.
It took me a while to convince him to play it, but it is definitely worth playing now. Yeah. And it's good to see that, because normally most people would just look at that game and think, oh, it's another survival building game, but it's really, really not.
It's not even a survival game anymore. The model for it's changed.
Even stuff like Killing Floor 2.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Killing Floor 2. I need to go back and check that out because
like,
I got
it
that.
It came out. It had, like, you know, one level and, like, whatever. It wasn't a lot of content. I played it. I liked it a lot, but I felt like, you know, I played that one level or whatever was out when it first came out, you know, for a few days with my friends, but, like, you know, 10, 20 hours into it, and I was like, cool, done, and I'll probably never pick it up again.
What was that
and
for? Day, so?
Killing Floor 2.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And I'm probably missing a ton of really fucking cool shit, but I feel like I played the game, you know? Yeah. And I probably won't go back to it.
Yeah, I did the same thing. Yeah.
I've played the game for 600 hours.
Holy
and
shit.
Honestly, I can say, like, no problem that if you played it at launch of early access, you really aren't missing much.
Okay. Like, more stuff.
You're missing maybe one new boss, a couple maps, and a couple of guns.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah.
That's good to know.
Like if you're someone who likes repetitive shooting, which is like
if you like levels covered in blood, it's a good game to play. Literally,
if you like blowing shit up, constantly, and that's all you want to do. You just want to hop in, shoot shit, go for it.
That liquid physics stuff was pretty cool.
Oh, it's incredible. there's a microwave gun that kind of turns the enemies into basically liquid, I think. Just liquid. They just kind of melt. and it goes down staircases, and it pulls up at the bottom of staircases and hills. It's just incredible technology. Yeah.
That sounds like it'd be worth jumping back in to just check that one gun out.
Yeah, but see, like you say, if you've played it initially and you come back, there's no interest, you have no reason to go and check it out. So.
Yeah, and I mean, and I think with Dusk, like, we've been talking about when we should start taking pre-orders and stuff, because, like, people are, like, asking for it. Not only, you know, I'm not a huge fan of pre-orders unless you really incentivize people and give them a lot of shit at the beginning. You know, it's like, if you pre-order, you'll get, like, a ton of stuff, you know, because you want to give the early adopters, like, as much as possible and keep rewarding them. That's, like, my business model with stuff, you know, like, and then they get everything free from then on out. Yeah. It's the people who wait 2 years to buy the game on a Steam sale, fuck them, they have to pay full price.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but the people who are with you on day one, like, those, the people who want to buy the game, like, immediately, reward them. So, like, I was thinking, you know, if we start taking pre-orders, we'll give people episode one when it's, like, finished, like, immediately. But even then, I'm like, what if they play that, and then by the time the game's out a few months later, they don't come back to play the rest of the game, they don't play multiplayer.
Yeah.
But at the same time, people really want the freaking game, you know? So it's, it's something I'm currently struggling with. Like, I want to incentivize people. I want them to, you know, get it in their hands. I want them to, because people are, like, trying to throw money at us, and I'm like, I can't take your money yet, although I do want to, believe me. But I want it to feel right, you know?
People begging to be able to pre-order it.
Some dude was
like, please let me pre-order.
Yeah, people were sending, like, PayPaling me money yesterday, and I'm like, don't do that. I had to refund, like, three people on the Discord. Yeah, some dude sent me $20.
Tell them to
bucks.
PayPal me money.
Yeah, I said you have a Patreon thing. They're like, no, I just want to, you know, send you, like, $20. I was like, I can't accept this yet. We don't have a game to give you.
I mean, I'm not working on the game, but you can send me money.
Yeah, right. But it's a really cool place to be in, right? As a developer, to have, like, a community that already is, like, trying to, like, fucking throw money at you. So we're stoked about that. We just have to figure out the right way to, you know, start getting, you know, the game in their hands, and then start, you know, taking money from them and feel good about the whole thing.
That must be a pretty big ego boost to you guys, like, having people already wanting to play the game without any wanting to pay full price.
It's frightening. It's frightening, actually, because
it's cool, but yeah, it's scary for sure.
Because, like, how I see it is, we've gotten so much shit the last couple of years, and to get a game like Dusk and the new Doom is so refreshing. It's just what we need, I feel.
Yeah. I mean, and then we have to, the coolest thing about Dusk is, you know, when we revealed it, like, we had the trailer, like, this is exactly what the game is, even though all the stuff in the trailer is only, like, episode one stuff, and then we put it this alpha, which is super duper solid. There's, like, not a single bug in the alpha that you have to go looking to find, like, you know, actual bugs and stuff, but it's super solid, and it's pretty representative of the game, and we had that, like, as soon as we revealed. And so we were able to really early get an idea of, is this okay? So that you like this, you like what we're doing, cool, now we're gonna go build the fucking game, you know. So all we have to do is just deliver that, you know, that alpha experience in 30 levels plus multiplayer plus co-op plus a level editor,
plus,
you know,
a few
plus
secret levels,
mode,
right?
And it's, yeah, and plus a few secret levels, yeah. And you know, it'll be great. That's all we have to do, no big deal, no pressure.
Well, so how far off do you think it is? Are we gonna get a 2017 release, or what do you reckon?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, well, Dave's, you know, Dave works night and day. David, I'm sorry, I'm Dave, he's David. I've just said 2017 because I hate to put, back when we were doing Rot, we kind of coined this thing just soon, TM.
Yeah,
you know, which was kind of like our version of when it's done, yeah, you know, the done, old 3D Realms thing.
Yeah.
Because I hate, especially today, if you put a release date on something and you have to push it, people get so mad at you. I've been telling people, like, summer, because it's starting to feel like summer. I mean, I think by March we'll definitely have episode. It's starting to move a lot faster as Dave's just cranking out, you know. David cranks out the levels, you know, we give him lots of crits, he iterates, he comes back, you know, we move forward. You know, and I think in a month's time we'll probably have episode one pretty done, and then, you know, moving on from there. It's just... definitely this year. I mean, I hope so. If the rest of the game takes us more than 2017, I don't know what's going on.
Yeah. David, how long does a level take you to make, just out of curiosity? Like, is there an average time?
I tend to work pretty fast, but the level in a state where I'm like, yeah, this is finished, isn't necessarily actually finished. That's why it's good to have another set of eyes, why it's good to send it out to Dave and him be like, no, none of this stuff here makes sense. And I'm like, oh, you're right. But... in getting it to the form where I'm going to send it out to him is probably, I don't know, 2 or 3 days maybe. Mm. And that's pretty, yeah. I think of like 12-hour days, it'd be about 2 days.
Okay.
So it takes some like work. 1 full day.
Yeah. But we iterate really fast. Like when Dave says, okay, I think E1L1's done, I'll just run through the level and take screenshots. I'll stop and I'll take a screenshot. Like, we should move this here. We should, you know, add, you know, less enemies here, another enemy here, different type of enemy here, some more set dressing here. Maybe this would be a good place for a secret. Maybe let's put this in the secret instead of this. You know, maybe let's start, you know, put a, you know, a monster closet event, you know, that happens here instead of here. Maybe it ends here, you know, just all, you know, just going through, and then we iterate again, then we play through it again. We go, wow, it feels a lot better now. You know, just different, you know, audio cues for Andrew to add for different events in the levels. Mm-hmm. And just, we just,
and it's iterate. It's really different for me to be working in that way, because I'm pretty much entirely self-taught. I never worked with a team on anything. I'm just this weird, awkward guy who makes games in his living room.
Hey.
And you're not awkward. You're amazing.
So it's really, really different to be working with other people on a game. And in a lot of ways, a lot better, because I'm used to just being in my own little world and making the game and having it make sense to me. And then it comes out, and for the most part, it'll work. And then other things won't work because I was living in my own little world and those things only made sense to me. So having the thing you made and sending it out to someone else and having them be like, no, this is none of this is it makes any sense. You need to change all of this. It's odd. It's a very different way than I'm used to working.
Yeah.
But it's ended up, like, the form, I originally, when I started Dusk, or when I realized Dusk was going to be Dusk, because it just kind of started as this, like, just a thing I was doing for fun. When I realized it was going to be a serious game, I'm like, okay, I know how long it takes me to make games. I've been making games for a long time now. I think this will be done by October 2016. And honestly, if I hadn't signed with New Blood, it probably would have been, but the game that would have come out would have not been great.
Yep.
It would have been Dusk at all. Like, the Dusk that you're going to actually get in, hopefully, summer 2017 is going to be a far, far better game than the one I would have released in October 2016.
It's just funny thinking back to that original build that you sent me, which was just the original build that Dave sent me. He sent it to me on Twitter. It was literally just a room with some weapons and a sink you could turn on and off, and like a toilet you can flush.
I think that was in the trailer, wasn't it? You guys put that in a video or something? Yeah.
Yeah, well, you could flush all the toilets in the game. You could flush stuff down the toilet. I mean, that's a must-have in any FPS.
You can't flush the toilet, you need that mechanic. Just drop it otherwise.
It was just a room, but he had the movement and the weapon feel down already. Like, literally just hopping around this room going, hup, 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 shooting stuff already felt so much. I was like, and 2 days later, I think we had a contract. I was like, I need to be involved with this game.
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, this, and you didn't believe me. I remember we hung out at QuakeCon, and you, like, you still didn't believe that I wanted to work on the game. Like, and even after we'd signed the deal and stuff, I was like, no, I am very serious. I need this in my life. I need to be deeply involved with this game. You've got something really special here. But I mean, those first few builds of Dusk, like, it's so different. Like, none of the enemies or that redneck rampagey feel was even, like, really there yet. Like, the leathernecks weren't there. The KKK mages, they were just, like, kind of like headless blob dudes that fucking came towards you. There was a lot of direction that just wasn't there yet. And over the months of going back and forth between us, it's kind of evolved into what you see now, and it's just it's so different. And I think that's just a great example of me and Dave both coming from the same history of single player FPS games and kind of really being kind of kindred spirits and that kind of stuff.
But and, having, you know, very different perspectives on the same basic goal, which is really good. I found the first screenshot I ever took of one of the builds just the other day, and there isn't a single thing in the screenshot that's still in the game.
if people go and find your personal YouTube, you've got Dusk videos from like almost a year ago where you're just testing like the weapons and stuff, and I hadn't even seen those when we started working together, and I was like, wow, it's such a different game.
Dave, you got a Twitter? You have a Twitter account?
He uses the Dusk Dev Twitter as his personal Twitter.
I was trying to
find
you before I couldn't find you. I was trying to do a bit of stalking to kind of research you a little bit. Yeah. Anyway.
You used to have one, right? And then what happened? Yeah. What happened there?
I just kind of wanted to detach from the drama that can show up on social media.
Yeah.
And
it's not because you killed that guy.
No. Okay, no, I'm proud of that.
Okay. We are going to talk about that time you killed that guy. Oh, man.
Andrew, I want to ask you, too, in terms of your process and everything, do you obviously need to play... I mean, do you need to play through the levels to kind of get a feel for things? Or, like, how do you go into that process of creating the music?
They just... They tell me what the game's about, and I'm like, cool, I'll see you in 10 months.
That's literally it.
What happens is they'll send me a build, and I'll run through it a little bit, but like the first thing I'll do is I'll start asking them ideas on what exactly they're looking for, and then I see how it differentiates on what my play experience is, and then I may come back to them and say, well, this is what I'm kind of feeling on this, you know, this is what I'm kind of feeling here. But for the most part with Dusk, it's everybody's kind of been on the same page. There's certain atmospheres that need to happen that are just, just atmospheric Doom 64 Quake stuff happening.
Yep.
And then whenever you start ramping things up and you run into a shitload of enemies, you know, pardon my French.
That's all
right. If you run into a shitload of enemies, you know, things
or
need to start
load.
Fucking ramping up.
Oh, so yeah. It's going to be a dynamic kind of thing, yeah?
All right. If Well, not exactly dynamic. It's more, since they're hand made level design, it's more scripted. Okay. Like certain things happen.
Yeah, when then, we originally started doing it, we used Doom 2016 as a reference a lot. You know how Mick would he created those tracks to be able to loop in and out depending on if you get in trouble or not. You know, the more enemies on screen, the music would ramp out, then it would ramp down, and that was kind of dynamic. And we originally envisioned stuff like that, but then we realized with Dusk being so, you know, everything being so scripted and handcrafted that Andrew
just
could we
probably
could,
wouldn't work. Yeah.
Yeah, David could create these sections, you know, with, you know, certain monster closets and triggers and stuff where Andrew, where he goes, all right, Andrew, I need a stinger here for the music to fade out and then something to fade in with a boom. And then, you know, it becomes less atmospheric and more, you know, the music amps up and then it amps down again. And it comes into a different type of track. And you could handcraft the music basically the same way we're handcrafting the levels.
Mm. Or it turned into this in the reverse. Actually, sometimes he's the enemy. Here's this track I made, and I'm like, well, this track's awesome. I need to find an awesome place to put it, so I need to make an awesome part of
it. That happens too. Like, Andrew can make stuff, and then David designs an area around, you know, the music, which, you know, works just as well.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure where I heard this, but somewhere in one of Andrew's videos, someone said that you were originally going to work with Mick on Dusk. Is that true at all?
On Dusk?
No. No, originally I was going to do the music.
I think that's mixed up with IDKFA. Mick was originally going to work with me on IDKFA at one point.
Yeah, okay. The Doom Metal Master thing, and then Mick got busy doing Mick Gordon stuff, I guess.
Yeah,
which is, I mean, it's arguably the biggest thing of his career, so who can blame him, you know?
I got to say, too, with the Brutal Doom 64 mod, I know you did the main menu thing, yeah? You did, like, the theme?
Yeah.
Was that right? Yeah. How did that come about?
Because
that's kind of a random kind of thing to do, isn't it?
We've known Marcos for a while.
Yeah.
Like Marcos and me have been pretty close since the Rot days, and we've stayed, you know, we've played things pretty close to the chest. Just with doing IDKFA and with Doom 64, we kind of keep in contact. Hey, what are you working on? What are you doing? What's next? That kind of stuff. And
I mean, you
kind of feel out
Doom theme too. I mean, he used that for the title track for Little Doom version. Well, what, the final version? Is it ever going to be final? What's he up to, 22 now?
Yeah. Oh, I don't know if he's up to that one, but it's just going to be never ending, I think.
Essentially, like, that came up, like, I think just a few weeks before I signed on to do Dusk, which I was like, cool, all right, I guess this will be, you know, just target practice. If you look at my YouTube account, whenever actually just uploading random things, there's probably a deal that I've signed somewhere where I'm just getting ready to start something else that's in the vein of it.
Yeah.
Because everything that I do with that stuff is target practice. And that's what the Brutal Doom 64 thing was. It was kind of target practice going into this.
Mm.
And it kind of fits the tone and the atmosphere a little bit with it. But
Doom 64 is so fucking great. Because I never played Doom 64.
It's such a different flavor to Doom. It's kind of on another level, yeah.
And I love the fact that I think they consider it canon now, right? They reference it, and they reference parts of it in Doom 2016.
Matto could probably confirm that. He's the resident Doom expert.
So how...
Here we go.
Based on the story, all the Doom games and all the wards were made are canon, technically.
Including Hentai Doom, technically.
No. Yeah.
Technically, in some plane of existence, Hentai Doom is canon.
Sick. In my plane of existence... It's canon.
I mean, like, maybe Doom Guy wants to, you know, take a break every now and then.
Yeah.
it's up to your imagination.
Yeah, but it's just great. Because Brutal Doom 64 is basically Marcos took all the N64 sprites and threw them in GZ Doom and, you know, made it look like that. But, I mean, just being able to play Doom 64 with a mouse and keyboard and mouse-looking stuff at, you know, 120 frames per second and have it's basically like a whole new Doom game that I never got to play when I was 12 because I didn't play it on N64.
It was also super, super, super dark on N64. It was hard to play back in the day.
But the soundtrack in that game is just, you look at Doom on the PC, you know, I mean, Doom 93 or whatever, and then Doom 64, and it's like night and day. Those soundtracks are just so different.
So here's another little gem with that, which was... The first two or three tracks, like ambient tracks from Doom 64, from Aubrey Hodges. I actually took those and kind of rebuilt those myself, just kind of like with a modern idea. But I never did anything with them. I was about to hand them over to Marcos, but I was like, if I don't have all these together, there's no fucking point.
Yeah.
And plus, Aubrey Hodges' stuff is pretty much like spot on. So I'm just gonna take this as what I should be doing for Dusk, but you know, here's the theme, you know.
it's not really music in that it's just kind of like, I don't know,
it's creepy
how
as
do
fuck.
You describe it, and there's like people murmuring and chanting. I don't know if you remember on the Xbox, if you ever left your Xbox idle for a certain amount of time, it would start making those noises. Does anybody else remember that?
Yeah, but on on the main menu.
Xbox in general, it would just make these really weird noises. It kind of reminds me of that. I've got like a kind of nostalgic fear attached to it when I hear it now. It kind of creeps me out a little bit.
Well, the thing is,
you need to open that thing up, man.
Well, after Romero left and stuff, and Doom became more and more of a horror game, which I think peaked at Doom 3, and everybody was like, you know, wow, they're really just trying to make a fucking horror game at this point. But I mean, like, all the different iterations of Doom was mostly Carmack just like being like, I bet I can make it run on this. Tell me I fucking can't. Dare me. Say I can't make it run on a fucking Raspberry Pi. I'll do it. You know, and just getting it to run on... Well, I have the SNES version of Doom. That's it's awful. It's so bad.
I've got the 32X version, which is arguably worse. Yeah.
Barely even see it. But versions like the Doom 64 was amazing, and the PlayStation 1 port of Doom is like a whole different game. Regular Doom is like GZ Doom, just playing it is my favorite version, but port wise I have the big box, the Williams version, right here sitting next to me at my desk, because I keep it. Just it's a whole other fucking game, you know, the real-time lighting, all the stuff they did with the, you know, the PS, because of the power that the PS1 had. It had a whole new soundtrack. It was so much darker. It was as fast as Doom, but it was terrifying. It was like actually scary.
It was basically Doom 93 meets Doom 64.
They have Doom 2's enemies in that as well?
Yeah, they had Revenants somewhere in there. Yeah.
And they had the super shotguns in there.
Yeah. It was a mixture. It was a really cool blend.
That's the great thing about Doom. Just keep remaking it and porting it. It just gets different. There's just so many different ways.
Everybody likes that story and likes that game for sure. Yeah. Well,
plus the mods. Like, we were playing this one the other day where it's called LCA or something, Matto?
Yeah, LCA, Complex Doom LCA.
And it just takes, it's like Borderlands, but the enemies have just insane amounts of health points and you get killed in two hits. It's just like, if you think you're good at Doom, give this mod a try and it'll just kick your ass. It'll rip you in half.
Yeah, what was what's that one that Doom mod that came out a few weeks ago? Run For It? where it gives all the ammo and everything legs.
Yes.
Everything in the game just starts running away.
Do you guys watch Icarus on YouTube? You know Icarus Lives?
Yeah.
I think he played Dusk,
didn't he?
He might have. I don't know if he did a video on it. We're going to try to interview him, actually, hopefully next week or something. But, he's kind of like my go-to source now for Doom mods. And some of them just come out are just bizarre. Like, I don't understand where people are coming from. There's one where it's got 3D models in the Doom engine. It looks like a Resident Evil kind of game. And the textures are really high res. And it's got, like, a dynamic light source with the torch. And it's just, this is the Doom engine we're talking about. It's like a 20-year-old engine. Or over that now, right? It's like 23 years or something.
Yeah, it's crazy. What's that? I was playing that Wolf Total Conversion Blade of Agony.
Yeah.
It's got like a hub world and stories and quests, and it's like, I'm like, holy shit, this is insane.
Yeah. Who has this time?
Yeah. I mean, listen, all you need in life is Z-Doom. It's funny. Like I went down to PAX OS. I came down to your end of the world.
Yeah, Melbourne.
And the plane ride down there is 15 hours. So I loaded up my laptop with like all, you know, I was like, what do I need? And I load all these new games on Steam that I haven't played, you know, Thumper and all these things. I spent the whole fucking plane ride playing Doom mods.
Yep.
You know, I played mostly Brutal Doom 64, played some other stuff. You know, just if you got WADs, what else do you need in life?
Yeah. All right, well, let's wrap it up on that note. I wanted to ask you guys, that's actually a good segue. If you're stuck on a desert island, right, for the rest of your life, and you got to pick one FPS game, I'll give you. You can think about it if you want. Is there one FPS game you reckon you could just play for the rest of your life?
Yeah.
Probably Doom, honestly.
Yep.
Doom.
Pretty safe.
I've been playing Doom longer than any other game.
Should I chill and say Dusk? Let's say Dusk, you guys.
Dusk.
Dusk with co-op features would be,
Yeah, we're working on it eventually. It's got to be Doom. I can't think of any game that I can just play. Yeah.
Its replayability is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Forever. Literally forever. But I think we're all kind of biased in that regard. Yeah.
Well, I played World of Warcraft for about 3 years straight. Literally pretty much every day, and I still reckon I've played Doom more collectively over my life than that. And I was into World of Warcraft so much that like I lost a girlfriend and I lost a job. Like, that's how addicted I was. But I think Doom takes a cake.
I had a friend like that.
Yeah.
I think everybody's had either knows somebody or has been somebody like that. I mean, I used to raid like fucking 5 days a week. It was a second job. You come home from work, Fuck him. I'm like SSC and stuff, Burning Crusade, Black Temple. Those were, I was deep, dark, dank into WoW in those days. Oh,
back
man.
In the Leroy Jenkins and Anixia Wipe days, man. It was a good game to play back then. Yeah.
I was getting like, I was on some world first teams and stuff like that. I never got like a thank you letter from Blizzard or anything, man.
Yeah. Well, cool, guys. How can we, how can we support the game and where can we check you all out? What's the best place to get in touch with everyone? We got the Discord server, obviously, the Twitter page.
So discord.gg/newblood. That's where you can, you know, come hang out. We drop Dusk keys in there. The Twitter page is @DuskDev. Newblood for all our games is @TheNewBloods. The website for Newblood is newblood.games. Or, you know, just Google Dusk game on Steam. You know, it's up on Steam. You can wishlist it. You know, we use the forums and stuff. We've mostly been using the Discord now. I mean, honestly, the best place is jump into Discord. I mean, we're doing this Discord's talk awesome. Right here on Discord. Yep. Discord's been great. I wasn't, like, when they came to me and they were like, hey, do you want to start one for your community? I was like, I don't know, a whole other thing. I don't want to manage, like, message boards and stuff like, ooh. And then we started using it. I'm like, this is great. How did we ever have a community before this?
Yeah. Yeah, and
so, discord.gg/newblood. That's the best place for sure.
Yeah, Andrew, you've got a YouTube channel too, where you're putting up all your music and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, it's kind of weird. I actually made the name when I was
Nukem Dukem Forever. Come on,
No. That's NUK Dukem for never.
Google Andrew Holschult YouTube.
Just Google it and you're all good. Yeah, but the Twitter handle is mostly where I'll do a bunch of that stuff. That and Facebook, but Twitter for the most part.
Andrew
Holschult. You want your face to melt off.
Do what?
Listen to your music if you want your face to melt off.
Yeah, if you're listening to that, if you're listening, there's a good chance you know Andrew's stuff. But go back and listen to all this stuff. You know, the Rot soundtrack, IDKFA, some of the other stuff. I think you got to do more. You got to do more Sasha stuff, man. You got to do more Quake stuff, Quake 2 stuff.
I've thought about it.
What's your favorite track from the original soundtrack? Me and Matt were talking about that before.
Which original? Doom?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just say Doom 1 just to make it easier.
My favorite one from Doom. Jesus Christ, I did that whole thing. Yep. And if Jesus I had to Christ pick one, I'd probably... He has nothing to do with this. I'd say it's it's probably E1M8.
Oh, no.
Is... No.
We were talking about this. We thought it was the weakest one in the whole episode, in the whole first game. Yeah.
No, because what that whole piece of music for that, like, just it turns the game on its head, man. Yeah. Like it's such a cool piece of music, because it's like you get there and then you just shoot the barrels, and it's just like this whole thing where it just sounds like super depressing, and then
well, what we were thinking about was it's a good song, it really is, but it doesn't suit the map. That's what me and Gareth were trying to
yeah, exactly. Yeah. It doesn't fit the map.
Yeah, over this stuff, me and Meadow. Yeah.
It doesn't fit the map until you get done with the Bruiser Brothers, and then everything just comes down, and you're like, what the fuck is this?
When you enter that kill room where you're just inevitably going to die, that track works, but only for that session.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, see, I did a... I was just saying, I did a remix of Dark Halls when I was in uni for my sound class and got like a high distinction at the time. You know, I think it's M3, I think, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, it's one of my favorite pieces of video game music of all time. I just think, and I love your rendition of it too. It's just it just always sounds good. It's just got this great beat, and it's like kind of a little bit depressing, but it's got a cool kind of sound to it. And yeah, I just think that's a perfect soundtrack. Well, the thing about
Dark Halls is it goes really well with the weapon sway and movement speed.
Yeah,
yeah.
Doom one, it kind of like as you like picture yourself swaying back and forth with the shotgun for Dark Halls. I love what you did with Imp Song E1. Was that E1 M2? Just the slap bass,
dude. It's funny you guys are bringing up all these songs, because I picked like six songs to do this talk on today.
Yeah,
that I recorded the whole thing. I'm about to upload it to YouTube, the whole talk about it, like awesome. Over at this thing called FadeCon, and these are the songs I went over. Like Imp Song was like, I was like, what do we need here? And I was like, oh, like Robert Trujillo on bass. Yeah, Robert Trujillo on bass needs to happen for Imp Song. And, you know, like the E1 M8 needs to be just grander and bigger, and it needs to come to more of a head kind of thing. And all the stuff for IDKFA, yeah, it's cool. I'm glad you guys picked this kind of stuff up.
You know what's good is E2 M8. That's a good one. That fits, I think, the tone of that level.
That is that Demons from Adrian's Pen? What is that? What is that?
I don't know if I can get it up, because it'll probably come up on the thing, but...
Nobody told me about id.
Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah, nobody told me about id.
Yeah.
I posted that up. That's a... God damn it, how does that go?
Is that a good rendition, though?
Yeah. And like, that's Tower of Babel, right?
Yeah, and this weird weird kind of synthy thing kicks in, like it's barrel, barrel, starts coming up, and you come around that corner, and you see the Cyberdemon there, and it's just kind of all over, yeah.
I just pulled up your remake of it, and the top comment on that video is
Andrew Holschult. Yeah.
That's fucking great.
Yeah, no, it's like that was so cool to do with that one, because that one was so weird. I was like, this isn't a song for a cyber demon, you know, when I'm like, it needs to be heavier.
I think
so that song's more like a song for your death, in all honesty.
Yeah,
it's very annoying. Yeah, for sure.
What's funny about YouTube is that comment thing you were just mentioning. I was going through the Doom 2 soundtrack, and people do this thing now where they combine like soundtracks into one file, so you've got this like 3-hour long thing. And I was listening to Doom 2, and you can probably find it. It's probably still there, and it's a Doom 2 soundtrack thing. And my comments down there from like 4 years ago, and I've said, why the fuck did you put this into one file? <It's> about 4 or 5 years ago. And it was like a really shitty, tinny, like, you know, there's a different MIDI sound that's like really shitty. And I don't know. I think I just wanted to find one track, and I've had to listen to this 3-hour goddamn thing, you know?
This is going to sound weird, but have you guys ever listened to the, I think it's the Doom 2 soundtrack, like on like, this is totally obscure and this is probably just me, but on the uploads that were from like Game Boy.
No,
actually,
dude,
what?
Dude, they're pretty fucking cool. Yeah, they're pretty cool. It's like, it sounds like almost like these old shitty like synthwave synths that they're using for it.
Oh,
but
yeah,
they're super heavy. The Demon's Dead version, like in Game Boy, like they took it down like a step, a full step, and it's just so heavy.
Oh, okay, righto, yeah.
I'm listening. I'm actually listening to Running from Evil right now. It's just, it's hilarious. Just the way they handle ride symbols and stuff.
Yeah.
Because some of them.
Some of them are terrible, but some of them are awesome. Like, the Demon's Dead is great.
There's definitely an appeal to old-school kind of music. Some of my favorite music, too, is from, you know, Sega Genesis or Mega Drive. Like, you ever heard the Boogerman soundtrack? It's one of the best soundtracks from the whole console.
Yes.
That's an Interplay game, too, actually. Speaking of Interplay.
I remember Boogerman. I don't remember it having a great soundtrack.
It has the first level is one of my favorite songs, too. I think it's called Boogerville or something like that. No, it's called Turd Swamp, I think.
Didn't they do a Kickstarter for a new Boogerman?
Yeah, they did. Yeah, they were trying to remaster, I thought, or it was like a updated version. Yeah, with hand drawn sprites too, like hand-drawn really boogers. Really well detailed boogers. Yeah.
No, it didn't make it. It failed on Kickstarter.
Yeah, that was the first game I think I ever played at least, and I think still the only game where you can fart in. It was just amazing technology, and you could hold it in. You could like hold it in for a really big one and let it out. It was devastating.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
What was stupid is it was controversial.
Back then, yeah, I imagine that being what was controversial.
Thinking
back to the video game controversies of the 90s, it's just like, really? That's what people got mad about?
Yeah. Well, Doom was a big one,
Death
too.
Race?
Yeah. My Death Race. Carmageddon was another good one when that came out.
Carmageddon.
Yeah.
Well, I remember as a kid someone telling me, there's this game where you get points for running over people. I was like, where?
Old ladies.
Yeah. Old ladies with walk. I need this.
Yeah. I need a walk. Yeah, yeah.
The little CGI track, a mini intro to that game is fucking amazing with that soundtrack. I forgot what it's called.
Is the new Carmageddon any good?
I heard it's questionable.
I've heard mixed reports.
Yeah, it's a little questionable. I got it. It works. But you get tired of it, and the way they did the it works. Let me go work in marketing now. But the way they structured the campaign totally, I felt like broke it. But I was totally supporting them from day one. Like I'd get on all their streams and be like, you know, hey, awesome, cool, just comment on stuff, just leave positive comments, because it didn't look like they had a shitload of people behind him at the very beginning, which was weird. I was like, what the fuck, are you kidding me? This is Carmageddon.
The cool thing is you can get 1 and 2 on Steam now, and they run great on Windows.
Yeah, they run awesome.
Well, you know what's funny is that they've censored the the health kit icon. What was I playing recently with? It was in Duke Nukem. They've taken it out of Duke Nukem because the Red Cross apparently copyrighted that symbol. So you go play the new Duke Nukem, and it's got a completely different icon on the health kits.
You're not allowed to put crosses on health kits in video games. Can you believe that? Like, I think it's the most insane thing of all time.
It's unbelievable.
What are we going to use instead?
It's got a pill on it now, like a sort of a, I don't know what you call it, like that cliche pill, like the Dr.
like
Super,
Dr.
Mario pill. Yeah, literally. Yeah. You would never think that'd kind of happen, you know?
That's teaching young ones good values. Here, instead of going and getting aid, just take pills.
Yeah,
but it's the Max Payne set of values.
Yeah, I can remember.
Yeah, pills will ease the pain.
Yeah, Wolfenstein 3D. I think you could drink blood in that if you had health low enough too. That's another thing that then they kind of censored the Nazi imagery out of
that.
Eat the
corpse. Yeah, you could eat the corpses.
Yeah.
Good delicious. Times.
Yeah. You never get away with that these days. I think you could eat the dog food in New Order, couldn't you? Matto would probably correct me on that.
Yeah.
Pick up dog food.
Yeah.
Yeah, New Order was so good, and Old Blood I thought was even better. Yeah, fuck those.
Old Blood was awesome. Yeah. It was like Indiana Jones on steroids.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know they got a new one cooking. I can't wait.
Yeah.
Well,
I'm hoping for a single player sort of campaign or a DLC for Doom, some kind of expansion.
That'd be
awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like, I don't know if they're going to do that, if they're just going to jump into,
I don't think it's going to happen. Yeah.
I think they finally released the last piece of multiplayer content, so fingers crossed. Single player, please.
Well, that multiplayer, I don't know how you guys feel about that, but that was a little bit of a disappointment. I didn't have my hopes pulled into it, but yeah.
People, were flipping out, but like, you got to remember, Doom multiplayer was never a big thing. Quake is what revolutionized it. Multiplayer. Talk to people, like, get in people's space. Like, did you actually play Doom multiplayer? Because I'm pretty sure you didn't, because it was hard. getting fucking Doom multiplayer going back in the day on a 2400 baud modem was not easy. You had to go on AOL, find someone to play with, then find their IP address, type it in, do the thing. It wasn't like Quake. Quake World was what finally, made the WASD mouse look, multiplayer 1v1 Quake style, revolution happen. But like, people were expecting, you know, Quake style multiplayer from Doom, which would have been awesome, but like I wasn't mad about it. I remember the first time I played it at QuakeCon, I don't know, 2014, 2015, the first time they showed it behind closed doors, and I played it. I sat down. It was me, Logan, and Kane, you know, from Tech Syndicate.
Yeah.
And we sit down, and the first thing is a loadout screen, and Logan just goes, "Loadouts? Fucking load? What the fuck is this?" And I was like, "Hey man, you said it. I was thinking it. I was like, hold on." And I was like, "I hope." And I remember I ran into Willits, and I was like, "Can you make it faster?" And he was like, "Fuck you, Dave." You know? And I mean, I'm not mad about how it turned out. It was still pretty fun. Like, me and you played a bunch of Doom multiplayer. Like, it's still really tight and really fun. But I think.
We played a shitload of that on the beta.
Yeah, I think it's just, it's not, compared to how old school and perfect the single player was, the multiplayer being anything less than that was going to be a letdown regardless. Yeah. But I mean, the single player is so good, the multiplayer doesn't even drag it down.
Yeah, but plus it was developed by different people, wasn't it? The same guys who did Halo?
Yeah. They're based in Austin, I think. They're cool dudes. But I mean, listen, I like the multiplayer. Would I wish it was more like Quake? I just don't know why they don't just get rid of fucking, or just give me a mode where there's no loadouts and I can just pick up weapons around the level.
They've added that option.
I think they've actually added that.
They have, yeah.
So they added deathmatch, but does it still have like loadouts and stuff?
No, it's got weapons.
I think it's got weapon spawns. Yeah.
So we're golden.
Yeah. But it wasn't like that on launch, which was kind of, you know, the main
issue.
Which
is weird. You know, you would expect it to be there on launch, but I mean,
you'd expect that they pander to old school crowd, like just to buy them in so they start telling their friends about it.
Yeah. Well, the old school ones are the ones who are going to bitch about it more than anyone else. The new players will just play it and go on to the next things. Old school ones are the ones who are going to sit there preaching about it. Like,
plus, there's so much game. I remember when I platinumed, what is it? There's no word for it on Steam when you 100% a game, but I got all the achievements. Yeah, I platinumed it on Steam. And then I dove into the multiplayer, and then I was like, holy shit, I've still got this whole snap map thing to do. There's a ton of fucking game.
Yep.
And dude, like, that was $60 well spent in 2016. There's not a lot of games that come out these days where you're like, there's a lot of freaking content here. Like, Doom was one of those games, man. It was packed to the walls with shit to do. You could play that game for weeks.
I mean, I got all the achievements as well, but as soon as they released the multiplayer DLCs, they added achievements, so you have to technically, like, spend money to get the other achievements, which is heartbreaking.
Multiplayer achievements for me as a game designer and shouldn't have to force people to play multiplayer, because not everybody is going to play multiplayer, and if the multiplayer community dies, or if you can't get a multiplayer game, you can't get those achievements, and it's not fair.
Yeah.
I remember there was an achievement for a Ghost Recon game where you had to get rank 1 to get it.
But the thing is,
no one plays it.
Yeah.
So that's an achievement you'll never get in your life.
Yeah, like in Rise of the Triad, there's no multiplayer achievements. You can get single player achievements by playing multiplayer. Like, I think we had get 666 kills with each one of the weapons, and you can rack those up in multiplayer. But there were no multiplayer specific achievements. We did that on purpose.
Well, a lot of the console games. I remember PS3 games. Like, I played Uncharted for a while, and when they brought out new achievements with the DLC stuff for the multiplayer, it was an optional achievement. So if you're already platinum, I actually platinumed those Uncharted games. It didn't count towards your total. So just two different ways of kind of looking at it. But that's why those games, like, I tried to start playing Modern Warfare 3 and I can't get in a server because I don't have all the DLC packs. I don't have all the extra map packs they released. There's no games. No one's playing it. Yeah.
And that's how sad is Modern Warfare Remastered? I still haven't played it because I don't want to fucking buy Infinite Warfare.
What a
terrible
business model to release that. That's a massive fuck up.
And then they also are releasing like paid DLC for Modern Warfare Remastered. It's an HD remaster of a game that came out fucking 7 years ago.
Yep.
Not 7 years ago. What, 17 years ago almost? When did Modern Warfare come out? 2004?
11 years ago. Oh, no, 9 years ago. It came out in 2008, I think, the first one.
And they're trying to like nickel and dime with map packs. They're like, really? And it's already dead because, they made it so hard to get the damn game.
That's the best
answer. I don't think there's any argument
that the remaster would have sold way better than Infinite Warfare if they released it individually.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I understand why they packaged it together. It was a good idea to, like, hey, buy the thing that you kind of maybe want and get the thing that you really want.
Yeah.
I'm just hoping that eventually they release it as a standalone and, add a server browser and stuff so I can go fucking play Modern Warfare like I want to.
That's what Wolfenstein
did.
They
split the communities on PC as well. If you bought it on the Windows Store, you couldn't play with the Steam players.
Mm.
Yeah, I think that was a joke.
So there were, like, maybe 20 people who bought COD Remaster. on Windows Store.
Well, I know,
That's awful.
I know Wolfenstein did the same thing with New Order. I mean, if you guys remember when you pre-ordered Wolfenstein, you got access to the Doom beta, and everyone just pre-ordered. Yeah. But Wolfenstein New Order ended up being awesome. But you know, so many people just said, "I just want to play the Doom beta, so I'll just buy this game," and they would have sold so many units just based on that.
That actually really pissed me off because, like, I obviously pre-ordered Wolfenstein.
Oh, but you got
like,
about 3 days earlier.
Getting the Doom beta, man, that was fucking amazing. Even though I played the alpha, I wanted the beta. But the fact that they didn't open beta was like, that just fucked me over.
Yeah. Plus, like I said, you got it about 3 days before the rest of the people, so you didn't even get that much time to play it before anyone else, so it was a bit of a silly thing. But yeah, that Modern Warfare remaster was just a, that was just a train wreck, the way they handled that.
It's a shame, because like, the Modern Warfare is arguably the best modern Call of Duty. I still, I think I like COD 2 the best
overall.
Yeah,
that's my favorite, yeah.
But Modern Warfare, man, what a fucking game. Well, when it came out, that was...
kind of turned the industry on its head. It was the first, I guess, of those modern shooters, and it just spawned so many others. I've got these games that someone sent me, actually, on my cabinet here. It's called, what is it, Terrorist Takedown 1, 2, and 3. You heard of those?
No, are they just like COD ripoffs?
They're just shitty COD ripoffs. The screenshots on the back look like stock images.
Terrorist Takedown.
Yeah,
that sounds like a game that I need to check out.
That sounds like a
mod game.
It sounds like a movable fucking video game. You know?
Yeah, yeah. The screenshots, if you saw them, they're just about as generic as it gets. It's pretty hilarious. So.
It's a Gary's mod.
Yeah, straight out of Derek's mod. That's what it sounds like.
I think I need to check that out then. Bad game with guns.
Well, I was kind of honored when I got them sent, but then I looked it up on eBay and they're about like $3 each. So it's not like there's much going into them. But
I love obscure stuff. That reminds me, after Dusk, we should remake William Shatner's Tech War.
I can't believe you guys have played that. I've never met anyone else who's played that game.
What, really?
I'm telling you, Dave.
I played Chasm. We played everything. Chasm, yeah, you're a big there's literally dozens of us. You and the Ricochet guy can go hang out together.
How about a
there were literally dozens of Chasm fans.
How about a remake of Witchhaven? You remember Witchhaven?
Yes, yeah. Witchhaven was
I could never finish it because it always crashed, and even when I ran it on DOSBox it just runs like horse shit, but I'd love to actually finish it.
Yeah, there was this guy who was trying to get the rights to Kingpin.
Oh, but that's already on good old games. That already runs
Kingpin.
Pretty well. Yeah.
Yeah, it runs fine. It's not the kind of game you need to remake, but I mean, it'd be nice to get a decent source port, you know, to get full on.
That's a really funny game.
I just remember the engine for that game where, like, the character models would kind of have, like, this liquidy, you know,
Quake 2 engine thing. There's a cinematic in that just still cracks me up when, like, a transition to another level, some guy's giving you a ride in his truck, and you get off the truck, and the guy in the truck says, "Hey, where's my $20? And the guy goes, "Here," and shoots him with a shotgun, and then he goes, "Fuck you," and then just walks off.
Oh, yeah, because they were really banking in on this is like this super hardcore adult game.
And this is the protagonist.
Swearing.
Yeah, this is the guy you're playing as who just goes, "Fuck you," and just shoots this guy with a shotgun, and I thought, wow, this is me, this is awesome. Got the moral high ground in this one.
Yeah, Tech War was really cool just because it was kind of open world, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. You could go on a subway to go to each mission.
You could
basically
go on the subway and go around. It was like drug dealers, and it was kind of. I don't think I ever beat more than like, I don't even know if I ever beat a level of that game. I remember playing that game just kind of wandering around and maybe killing some drug dealers, and then I don't know if like there was ever an end to any of the levels.
If you mess up the levels, you got to get the CD version, because if you mess up, it has little cinematics of William Shatner telling you off. So you mess up a level and go, "You fucked up the level. You screwed it up." And that's, you got to kind of replay it. It's hilarious.
I'm being completely serious here, though. Like, completely serious. If I had the chance, I would make, I would love to reboot Daikatana.
I'd support that. I'd support it. I think it's way ahead of its time. Yeah.
Daikatana these days, with the patch that fixes the AI and shit, it's a fucking fine game. It's fine.
The level design is pretty good.
It's a good game. It has so many cool ideas.
Yeah. Do you know I bought that game?
I was gonna say the thing that dragged it down was the whole AI companion bullshit that never worked right at the time. Wasn't for that, it was just perfectly fine RPG. It was like different worlds, and different worlds had different weapons, and it was cool. It was a good RPG. It was a little dated by the time it came out, but it's good. It was just
episode
all that AI. having to get your fucking, you know, Superfly Johnson and friends to the end of the level without getting stuck on the geometry was what really hurt that game.
Yeah. The second and the third episode are really good. Like, they're really well designed.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Episode 1's a bit rough, episode 4's a bit rough, but 2 and 3 are actually really fun.
Oh, I was going to say that.
Weapons,
the, crossbow in Dusk reminds me of the, what's that thing called you got in Daikatana in the second episode? Is that inspired by it, or is it from the Hexen crossbow?
No, the one in Dusk is pretty much entirely just inspired by Heretic.
Hexen. Oh, okay.
The Heretic crossbow.
Oh, isn't the Hexen there's a crossbow? Oh, no, you're talking about the Ethereal
Heretic
crossbow.
Heretic is the one with the crossbow. Yeah, it's gotcha. Also better than Hexen. Yep, controversial.
Yep. Oh, I don't know. I'm thinking there's crossbow and Hexen. Claims. Crossbow and Hexen too, sorry, I'm getting confused. Yeah,
I'm the only... Hexen 2, there are literally dozens of us as well. You know, Hexen 2 wasn't a big deal because you go looking for mods and there's like 4 of them.
Yeah, that's it's a like, hard wow. game, man. Oof. That is a hard... That's the Dark Souls of FPS, like times 100.
Yeah, well, plus... Oh, it's super hard. Plus, there's also... That was on the Quake 1 engine, right?
No, Quake... Yeah. Oh, no, it was Quake 1, yeah, yeah.
No, it was Quake 1, which is why there's so, you know, few things for it, because by that point, people started putting stuff on Quake 2 engine. And Hexen 2 kind of got caught. But the whole... The dual sickles, if you remember, Dave, my whole inspiration came from that was Hexen 2 when you start and you play as a paladin and you bash your fists together.
Oh, that's right, yeah. Oh,
yeah, when you start and you go, psh, psh. Yeah, and I was like, that's what I told Dave, and I'm like, we need that, but for dual sickles. Originally, what was the original weapon in Dusk? Was it just like a hammer?
It was a hammer, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was like, this sucks.
Sickles
this
is like so much better.
I was like, this is like the axe in Quake. It just, we need something better.
Yeah.
You know, this is, and, sickles, what was originally, man. Yeah, what did we throw around? Like hammer and a, we were like, we need farm equipment. It has to be farm equipment. And then we talked about a scythe. And then we originally, and then I was dating a Russian girl at the time, and I was like, oh, what about a hammer and sickle, comrade? And then we eventually decided on tool sickles, and I'm like, you have to make them bang together like fucking Paladin bangs his, you know, hands together at the beginning of Hexen 2. Then you did it. You made that animation, like, shing, shing, and I'm like, perfect, done, that's it. Those are the starting weapons, because they're fun to use. I mean, that was the whole thing. Like, I wanted the starting weapons to be something that's actually fun to use, not something just, like, useless, like the axe in Quake.
Or the pistol in Doom.
Or the pistol in Doom. Yeah. And my one fucking thing that I dislike about Doom 2016 is the goddamn pistol.
Yeah.
It sucks when it's fully powered up. It sucks. It's not fun. Like, if they would have given you like a Magnum revolver instead, that would have been awesome, right? Yeah. Or like a 1911 or a fucking Desert Eagle.
Well, yeah. It is designated as the SFG, the small fucking gun.
That's funny. It's just not fun. It's not fun to fall back. And also in Doom 2016, also in Doom, fucking no fists.
Yeah,
glory kills.
Yeah, I know, but you can't like just punch stuff, you know, like you could in Doom 1.
I'll settle for ripping an imp's skull in half. I'm pretty happy with that.
Well, technically in the lore, Doom Guy has only used his fist for a very long time.
There you go.
So only
you
for
the lore. You can see carved in like big rocks that he just punches the shit out of shit. For like years.
That's pretty gangster just... though. The warrior in Hexen just kind of punches the shit out of everything. He's taken on the Serpent Riders, and I'm just going to punch my way there, man. If I get an axe along the way, all the better. But let's just punch the shit out of everything, you know.
Way to go into it. I modded up Hexen 2 recently and started playing it. It holds up pretty well, but it's a hard game. I was playing it. It's holding up pretty good. It's just it's a hard game. After a few levels, you're like I'm. Plodding Lost. Through. I don't want to play this anymore. Mm-hmm. I got to a town and I was like,
the order of things you need to do is just so obscure, and there's not really any indication. Like I made a video on it. And it's just there's 20 things you got to do in the first hub, and there's six hubs.
Yeah, so I'm going back. I got to go back to the windmill, and then to the well, and then back to this thing, and then through the town, and to the library. Did I do the thing? I had to go look up a walkthrough.
Yeah,
it's the first level of the fucking
it's
game.
It's just insane. Yeah, that's why I think it's a better game than Heretic, because it's just so much more advanced, and you know.
Oh, I love Heretic.
Heretic's good.
Heretic's good.
Just feels like a total conversion. That's all in that
sense. Well, of course I love Heretic. It's basically just Doom. and I love
with
Doom.
The crossbows. But also, you know, the best version of that is you might take it balls to the wall, and then you have Strife, which is basically that plus RPG stuff.
Yeah, yeah. We were talking about Strife to Steven. It was we were saying how it's just that game too is so far ahead of its time, and yet no one really knows about it, even though they remastered it and brought it out, and just no one really didn't really get much coverage again. You know.
It doesn't have to, and like, you know, I'm in the same train of thought as Steve. Like I said, we're friends, and like we're preservationists as much as we are into making new stuff. Like, it doesn't cost a lot to get that shit done, but I would do it a million times over just to have a playable version of the games we had as a child playable. Yeah. Like my idea is like if you get that hit of nostalgia, if something reminds you, like, what was that fucking game that I played when I was... Strife! Shit, I wonder if it's on Steam. And you go and you type it into Steam, it should be there, it should be available for a price, it should run on your operating system, and you should be able to install it and get that nostalgia hit. And even if you only play it for 20 minutes, which is probably what you'll do, I want it to be available, you know? Like, me and Steve are very much the same like that. Like, it's worth doing, even if it doesn't sell a ton, just because it's fucking worth doing, you know? Like, otherwise these games get lost.
Yeah.
This is why, like, Blood needs a source port.
I was going to say, you took it words out of my mouth. That's why Blood is the tragic example, because it's one of the best, and it just, and it's got no love.
I would say it is the best build engine game if it had a source port.
Where did I hear that? I heard just now, that. It was somebody's YouTube channel. He was talking. He had kind of an Aussie accent, and I think he said Blood. There was the holy trinity of build engine games. Yeah, Blood was the best holy one. You know that guy? He's a decent. Yeah. He's an okay guy.
No, he's
he likes Sage Doom a lot. He's kind of weird.
Yeah,
doesn't like Stalker enough.
No. Well, actually, you know, it's funny. Yeah, Steve's apparently a massive Stalker fan, and we interviewed him, then right as we finished, he's like, yeah, I love Stalker. And I don't hate that series, but I could spend all day talking about what's wrong with it. And I was like, whoa,
I am a massive Stalker fan.
Yeah,
it's and Doom are my... Yeah.
David's a big Stalker fan. There's a preset in Dusk that changes the color palette to really, really look like Stalker. What's it called? Straylock?
Straylock. Yeah.
Wow. It kind of washes everything out. It's one of my favorite color presets.
I probably left some, like, on your reviews, I probably left some sort of, like, you are actually wrong about this comment.
Was I rude back to you? Did I say anything rude back?
I don't remember.
sometimes I'm pretty good, but if I get really rude people, I kind of give it back. Like, if someone's constructive, I'll respond, but sometimes someone's like, you're a noob, get good, and I'll just reply with, like, fuck off. That's how I handle
it. You should see some of the shit.
But if it's constructive, and I'm willing to admit that game's just not for me. But yeah, that's the I don't know. That's the what you got to put up with on YouTube. Sometimes.
I'm a huge Metro fan. I feel like Metro's
good.
I fucking love Metro games.
Especially
I feel
on
like
that highest difficulty where you die in about two bullets. It's such a fucking good game.
Speaking Metro of dying in two bullets, did anybody? I've run through the entire arcade mode in Doom 2016 on Ultra Nightmare. Has anybody else done that here?
Yep, I've done that.
You're a masochist. I haven't played arcade mode. I've been meaning to reinstall.
It's really
I haven't played arcade mode and centered weapon models. Have you guys messed around with that?
Yes, they're the best.
Is it really? Does it really make it feel like?
No, it doesn't. I think it's stupid. Yeah.
No, it doesn't. I like them. Yeah. I think it makes them a little easier to aim with, personally. Yeah. But they're it's a gimmick. It's a gimmick. But
it's a cool gimmick, though. It's the kind of thing
it's
we
a cool
would
gimmick.
It takes up too much of the screen. The FOV.
Some of the stuff that's in Dusk, being able to decrease the screen size.
I love how you said we were going to wrap this up, and we've been going on for an hour now. every FPS ever. Hey, so did you guys play this? But like, let's be real. We knew it would happen.
Well, that's the problem when you're chatting with like-minded people. We just there's so much to talk about. I'd love to get you guys on again in the future too.
Yeah, we could do this every week.
Weekly show. Yeah.
Well, we're at 2 hours, guys, so that was a pretty good run, I think, and we covered some good ground, so that was awesome. Thanks again for having a chat to us, and we'll make sure we put out the deets for the game and get some people in the Discord and give the game some love, because, I don't know, it's looking fucking awesome, and we're not blowing smoke up your ass, we're really looking forward to it, so...
I'm actually going to go play it after the podcast,
We'll have... Episode 1 ready pretty soon, so we'll send it to you guys. You can make some videos and make everybody else jealous.
Awesome. And you got to give Matt away arm key so he doesn't keep bugging me, because he texts me at night. I just never hear the end of it if I don't get it, get him access to the game.
Does he not? Oh, does he not have his own?
Is no,
he,
I'm kidding. He does now.
I got my own yesterday.
Yeah, yeah.
If you went through your DMs on Twitter, I'm sure you could find me. Yeah. I was like kissing your ass hard, man.
all right, well, let's end it. But thanks, guys. And yeah, stay on the line after I finish recording, and we'll have a chat and wrap things up. Cool.
Sounds good.
Cool.